Welcome to the session number 2 of Gita course level 2, which is being held at SV Heights. Okay, before beginning the session, I would like to offer my obeisances and dedication to the Guru Parampara. Om Jnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtham Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakan Vitamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanusute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyayavacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Vrishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Iti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschate Deshutarane Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangham Langayate Girim Yadkripa Tabaham Vande Shri Guru Dinataranam Paramanand Madhavam Shri Chaitanya Ishwaram Harihi Om Tat Sat. So agenda, what is yoga, what are the different kinds of yoga, and the third point and the most important point, progression of the yoga ladder. How does one form of yoga lead to another form of yoga, and which, how does a yogi or a person who is practicing yoga progresses in this yogic ladder. After that we will analyze, since this is the bhakti yoga session, so we will analyze what is bhakti yoga and is the bhakti yoga complete in itself. And then Krishna's choice of yoga. So Bhagavad Gita has been told by Krishna. So Krishna is the basically the author of the Bhagavad Gita. He is the original person from whom the Bhagavad Gita is coming. So what is the author's choice of yoga? What is Krishna's choice according to Krishna? Which is the best kind of yoga? And then path back to the spiritual world. It can be achieved through yoga. So we will not miss that. And then we'll see the practical tip of the day. So are we all ready? Yes? Okay. First question before starting the session. What comes to your mind when we think about yoga? What is yoga truly? Please, whatever comes to your mind, you can say. This is an open discussion. Starting with... Okay, very very theoretical. This something practical. What is yoga?
Determination.
Okay, connection with soul, with supreme soul, and determination. Any other definition?
Yoga means
sit in a posture and breathe. Okay, breathing exercises. Okay.
Yoga means that only comes into mind, that some exercise, some asana, some
pranayama. And then my soul connection to.
Okay. Mind and soul connection. Okay. Jitendra Prabhu.
Self-realization of soul.
Okay. Yes, Prabhu. What is yoga?
Any work, what do I do? It's sincerely you work. Whether it is praying God or doing any other work. Sincerely and honestly. And that's yoga. Anything else.
Okay. Okay.
I know if it's true.
Huh?
I don't know how far it is true, but that is in my mind.
I know.
I don't know how far it is true, but...
You don't know how far it is true, but this is what you think. Yeah, no problem. Everybody can think. So, basically, we will understand what yoga is in this session. But before that, let's see what is the basic definition of yoga as per Bhagavad Gita, according to Shri Krishna. So it says, Yogastha Kuru Karmani Sangam Tyaktva Dhananjaya Siddhi Asiddhayo Samobhutva Samatvam Yoga Uchyate. Perform your duty equipoised, O Arjuna, abandoning all attachments to success or failure. Such equanimity is called yoga. This is the most basic, most preliminary, and the first definition of yoga which comes in Bhagavad Gita as per Lord Krishna. It says, basically, can you all try to understand this? Perform your duty equipoised. What does the word equipoised mean?
Sthit pragya.
O Arjuna, and how to become equipoised? Abandoning all attachment to success or failure. You know, whatever we are doing, that should be our duty first of all. Suppose something is not my duty, but still I am doing. Is it yoga? Yeah, for that you first should know that what I should do and what I should not do. You know, for example, coming here and let's say starting to ask what is the electricity bill of this house, this is not my duty. That is somebody else's duty. So if I start doing that, that is not yoga. Okay, so perform your duty equipoised, O Arjuna, and then abandoning all attachment to success or failure. Right now, the whole aspect of working or doing anything is, if I will succeed, if chances of success are there, then I will do, otherwise I will not do. That's not yoga. We should not be attached to whether we succeed or whether we fail. And when we start working in this aspect, actually the whole idea that I have good chance of success, this itself is illusion. How many times can we say that I'm thinking that I will succeed here, but our success is 100% guaranteed? Is it ever possible? Success depends on so many factors. It depends on so many things. So that's called as illusion. No, thinking that I am the cause of the results of the activities which I do. You know, the Bhagavad Gita says, Prakrite kriyamanani gune karmani sarvasha ahankara vimudhatma karta hamiti manyate. Only a bewildered soul thinks that I am the doer. So one who gives up that doer mentality and abandons all attachment to success and failure and works with an equanimity and equipoised mind, that is called yoga. Whatever is the definition of your success or failure? Generally, success is the motivation why people work.
Mostly personal gain.
Yes. Mostly. Yeah. But that is not yoga. That is something else. We will come and we will discuss that in full detail. So basically what this primary definition says, we have to become detached from something which is not permanent. Okay, basically become detached with matter. So, and being equipoised in both happiness and success, happiness and distress. Okay, so basically yoga is trying to go for a higher destination. When you become equipoised, when you become equanimous in your mind, and when you abandon all attachments to success or failure, in such a state of consciousness, when you do, when you work, when you do your duty, then you basically you live in a plane of existence which is more blissful than which you are maybe right now. Does it make sense? So basically yoga is meant for transcending the matter and going to a higher destination. So just for now, from this, we have to understand that we are trying to do something so that we go to a higher state of bliss, a higher destination. Does it make sense? Like Mataji said, yoga, linking of the soul with the super soul, that is also one definition. You know, getting established with our relationship with the Supreme Lord. The word yoga means link or add. Yogadan. You add something. So when you add your consciousness to the consciousness of the Supreme Soul, that is basically yoga. But these days, what do people say? Like Deepak who said?
Body and mind.
Body and mind. Mind also they never reach. Only body. The idea of doing yoga is come, do yoga, then go out, eat nicely, do whatever you want, drink whatever you want, behave whichever you want. But just every day morning 6 to 7 you come here, give us 5,000 rupees a month, we will give you a certificate in 1 month, and then basically do whatever you want. That is not yoga. Do you think by doing whatever you want, you can be detached from both success and failure? Do you think you will attain equipoised state of mind? Is it possible equanimity to attain?
No.
If you do not follow any rules and regulations, it's not possible. So basically, we have to transcend two things. Do not be disturbed because of matter. Equanimity means what? Equanimity means no matter what happens, what you lose, what you gain, you will not be disturbed. For example, this laptop, do you think this is permanent?
No.
It will stop working. No matter AMD is there inside or Intel is there, whichever is there, it will stop working someday. Correct. So, if I become disturbed by the presence or absence of, disturbed or happy by the absence or presence of this laptop, that means I'm not practicing yoga. So things which are temporary, detach yourself from that, and then being equipoised in both happiness and distress, so that you go to a higher destination or a higher state of existence, that is yoga. Okay, this is the basic definition. We will see a more mature definition towards the end of this session, which Krishna only will tell us. But for now, let's proceed with this. Any doubts in this? Does this satisfy the definition of yoga?
Yes.
Okay. So yoga is definitely not any breathing exercise or any asanas, and they are all parts of yogas, but this is the primary and the fundamental definition of yoga. Okay. Different kinds of yoga. Can someone read this out for me?
Sinful action.
Yes.
Not any yoga. Karma kand.
Karma kand.
Karma yoga.
Karma yoga.
Gyan yoga.
Gyan yoga. Dhyan yoga.
Bhakti yoga.
Bhakti yoga. These are the different kinds of yoga. Sinful actions, karma kand, karma yoga, gyan yoga, dhyan yoga, bhakti yoga. Theek hai? These are the different kind of things which exist. We'll discuss each of them one by one. Okay? Before seeing various paths, you know, I said yoga is one of the methods by which we reach some higher destination. So what are the available destinations which I have, which we can reach? See, these are the paths. These are the various paths. So by these paths, I want to go to various destinations. So what are the various destinations? Of course, all these paths will not lead me to the same destination. Different destinations they will take. But let's say if I'm following yoga, what are the available destinations I have? This we have covered in one of the previous sessions. Can someone tell me? It'll be a good recapitulation. Okay, I'll give you some hint. Sunlight, sun globe, and the presiding deity of the sun planet. Sunlight is there. Somebody who does not know that sunlight is coming from the sun globe, he will think the sunlight only is sun. Actually, there is no difference between the sun and the sunlight, correct? But the source of sunlight is sun globe. And someone who does not know that inside sun globe there is a personality called Vivaswan, to whom Bhagavad Gita was given millions of years ago first, he will not know the complete truth. So if, let's say, someone knows, there is a student who knows that, okay, sunlight is the source of light. Then someone says, no, sun globe is the source of light. Then someone says, no, Vivaswan, who is the presiding deity of sun planet, he is the source of light. So who's the highest student in this? Vivaswan is the highest student. The student who knows Vivaswan is the highest student, correct? Okay. So like this, can you correlate and tell me what are the various available destinations, Deepak Prabhu? Please louder.
Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagwan.
Yes, these are the available destinations we have. Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagwan. Okay, what are the highest destinations which are available? If somebody will ask, what will you say?
Brahman.
Nagi?
Brahman.
Brahman. Paramatma, Bhagavan. So by yoga, you have to achieve any of these destinations. Okay? Now, what is Brahman? Deepali Mataji will answer.
Spirit.
The spirit with which you will remove the nail polish, no? That is Brahman. What? I'm just joking. Any other answer?
Brahman means pure soul.
Pure soul. Spirit, soul. Okay.
Pious.
Okay. So, person who is not pious is not Brahman. Okay. I'm not saying Brahman. I'm saying Brahman. First, you have to understand what is Brahman. Any other definition of Brahman? This is a very, very important concept. We have to understand this. Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagwan.
The
originator. He is Brahman.
Persons which is coming from the one that is called as Brahman.
Okay. Accepted. So see, Brahman means, I give you the sunlight example, right? So, when somebody comes out of the material world, but does not have complete knowledge about the spiritual world, he goes in the Brahma Jyoti, okay? And that area is called as Brahma Jyoti. But Brahman means Sarvav Kalav Idam Brahman, means like everything which is of transcendental nature, which is of spiritual nature, which is of eternal nature, is basically Brahman. Now, soul is also Brahman, God is also Brahman, His energies are also Brahman, everything which surrounds you is basically His energy, so that is also Brahman. Okay, so basically, Brahman means the Lord or the energy of the Lord. So, a foundational definition of Brahman is spirit soul. Okay, so somebody who comes to the understanding that Aham Brahmasmi, I am spirit soul, he is called as Brahman realized. People think that I am the body, you know. Tamil Nadu people will fight with Karnataka people for which river? Kaveri river. They will say I am Tamilian, they will say I am Kannadiga. This is body consciousness. They are not Brahman realized people, correct? They are body realized people. So Brahman realized means I have understood that I am not this body. I have had so many bodies, sometimes a cat body, sometimes a demigod body, sometimes a human being body, but somehow I'm changing my body every time. So my permanent identity is the soul. So this is Brahman realization. Okay. After that comes the Paramatma realizations. Okay. What is the Paramatma realization? So Brahman basically like we discussed and like Mataji told, it's the all pervading aspect. Wherever you see the Brahman exists and it is omnipresent, means like, yeah, all pervading aspect of the Lord. The Lord is everywhere. That is Brahman. The spirit soul is everywhere. Okay, Paramatma means the all knowledgeable and all controlling aspect of the Lord. So Paramatma is there in all our, in all living entities' hearts. Don't think that it is in the heart of only human being. It is in the heart of a mosquito also. It is in the heart of, you know, amoeba also. It is in the heart of blue whale also. You know, everywhere the Paramatma is there. So, sarvasya chaham hridi sanna vishto matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha vedeshcha sarvair aham eva vidyo vedanta krid vedavid eva chaham. I give knowledge, forgetfulness and remembrances to all the people, and because of that they are wandering in various places in the universe. Sarvasya chaham hridi sanna vishto, I am there in the hearts. Matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha, I give remembrance and forgetfulness. Vedeshta sarvair aham eva vidyo, by all the knowledge of all the Vedas I am to be known. Vedanta krid vedavid eva chaham, all the Vedas sing about me. This is a very, very beautiful verse. So Paramatma is basically controlling everything.
Which shloka?
This is from Bhagavad Gita.
15th chapter.
So Paramatma is the all controlling aspect. Within our hearts he will remind us a few things. For example, how many of you remember what you have done in your previous births? Do you remember something? No. Because the Paramatma doesn't want you to remember. You know, but how many people of you remember what you maybe did 1 year ago? Many of you will remember because the Paramatma wants you to remember. So some things, in fact, these are samskaras. Some people will get attracted to something naturally. Like you people got attracted to Bhagavad Gita naturally. Same opportunity was given to all the people of SV Heights. They were all sitting, I'm not criticizing, but you just try to appreciate. All of you were sitting in level 1 in the hall below. You know, so many people were attending, but out of those people, why only you people came? Because you people had no other work to do? No, because the Paramatma in your heart, when he heard these messages of Bhagavad Gita, when you heard the messages of the Bhagavad Gita, Paramatma in your heart said, this is the right path, go on it. Because in your previous lifetimes, you have prayed to the Lord and you have done the same work. All of you have been studying the Bhagavad Gita in your previous lifetimes. That's why you are here. It's not like first time you are studying. Okay? You must be having such realizations. I also have had such realizations. The first time when I went to a temple and when I paid my obeisances, I felt that I have been doing this since so many lifetimes. And this is natural for me. So, sometimes the Paramatma gives you remembrance. That is Paramatma. He controls everything. And without the permission of Paramatma, not even a single blade of grass will move. Don't think that if somebody is coming to kill me, so it is like out of his desire. No. The Lord is arranging. Okay? And finally, is the Bhagwan aspect. Okay? So you see the third picture is the Bhagwan aspect, in which the understanding of the Lord, we understand that the Lord is a lovable person. More details. What he does, what he likes, how he dresses up, what he eats. And then best thing, we get a chance to do service to him. In Brahman realization, there is no scope for service. In Paramatma realization also, you see this yogi who is sitting here. No, I'll show you. This yogi, do you see? Simply sitting. That is Paramatma realization. But Bhagwan realization means chance to do service. How many of you people have participated in Swadutsav? That is service. This you will not get in Paramatma realization. So these are the three available destinations. Okay, different people have different realizations. So they achieve different stages. For example, a train, there is a first time a train is coming to a village. Okay, people of this village, have not seen the train before. All of them are waiting at the station to see the train. So first time when they hear the train coming, some villagers will be like, they'll immediately hear the sound and they'll run away to the village. Oh, train is a sound. You know, a sound which is coming and which is increasing every time, that is train. Some villagers will stay there. They will see some smoke coming out if it is a steam engine. And snake-like substance coming on the tracks, making a lot of noise. So they will say, oh, its train is not just the sound, but it is the smoke and the snake also. But some people who are more sincere, more Shraddhavan, they will still wait and they will see the train coming. Oh, train has come. Oh, train is not a snake. Train is a compartment where people are sitting. There is place to sleep, there is place to walk, there is place to do toilet. And train is like my house. Then he will go say, no, train is not just sound, not just the smoke and the snake or the body or the trail, but it is a place where people like you and me are sitting inside it. You know, it's unbelievable. Just like when we feel that, you know, in the sun planet, nobody can stay. But actually, a lot of people are staying there. But the bodily constitution of those people are different. So this is the Brahman Paramatma Bhagwan realization aspect. So in the knowledge of the train, Who is most advanced knowledge of train? Which knowledge is most advanced? The group which saw that train is an object where people are sitting and it has place to sleep, eat, dance, do toilet and everything. That is the highest realization. So similarly, Bhagwan is the highest realization. So yoga will take us to any one of these three destinations. That is yoga. Paramatma?
Is it kind of spiritual?
Paramatma is, all these three are spiritual.
Spirit soul.
Paramatma is super soul. Soul of your soul. You have a soul and your soul also has a soul. That is Paramatma. Atma's Paramatma. Supreme Absolute Truth can also be perceived as Brahman, Paramatma in every atom or the Supreme Bhagwan. Okay? Moving on, till now everything is clear? Now we saw this aspect. Now we will discuss all these things in detail. First, sinful action. What is it called? Action without regard to scriptures. There are many kinds of activities which we do. One action is like, don't believe in anything. Do what you want. It's my life. Okay? Just do whatever you want. Don't care what is written in Bhagavad Gita. You know, I like this, I'll do it. Simple. That's called sinful action. Acts against scriptures, and this is not a part of the yoga ladder, but it defines actions that don't fit into the yoga ladder. Yoga ladder means, yoga basically starts from the primary thing, or the primary, entry criteria into the yoga ladder is that adherence to the scriptures. You have to stick to what the scriptures say, then the yoga begins. But if you don't do that, then it is outside the yoga ladder only. So people who are not following the scriptures, and if they say, I'm a yogi, just smile and move away from that, because they don't know what they are saying. You know, yoga means basic adherence to the scriptures. There are so many people whom I know, they claim to be yogis, but outside the yoga studio they will do all nonsense things. You know, they are not yogis. Let them say that they are yogis. It's like a beggar standing in front of, you know, the Mantri Mall in Bangalore and saying that I own this mall. What will happen if he just thinks like that? Will he start owning it? So similarly, a person who is acting against the scriptures can never be a yogi. Okay, how many of us are acting against the scriptures? Almost all of us, some in very great degree, some in less degree. But the difference between them and us is, we have a aspiration, we have a goal that one day we want to base our life on the scriptures. Does it make sense, Nagi?
Yeah.
So are we yogis?
Trying to be.
That's very good. So we are yogis. Assume. Okay, moving on. Now, it says, Krishna is telling to Bhagavad Gita, O Partha, happy are Kshatriyas to whom such fighting opportunities come unsought, opening for them doors to the heavenly planets. Now I'm talking about Karmakanda. First I talked about sinful actions. Now I'm talking about Karmakanda. Karmakanda means adherence to the scriptures. Act according to the scriptures. So Krishna is telling to Arjuna what? See, those Kshatriyas who get fighting opportunities, you know, and if they do not run away from the battle, then if they fight nicely, they will go to heaven. This is the first proposition which Krishna is giving. He is saying, do karma kand. Arjuna is telling, I will not fight. Krishna is telling, do karma kand. Because as per the scriptures, you are a Kshatriya, and a Kshatriya cannot say no to the fighting opportunity. That is the dharma of Kshatriya. So you don't say no to this opportunity, you just fight. And if you do this, then doors for the heavenly planets will open. So here Krishna is inciting Arjuna based on the Karmakanda principle. He is saying fight and you will enjoy. So what is Karmakanda? I just tried to find some picture of some heavenly something. So this is what I got. So acts according to the scriptures, looking for one's own sense gratification, no desire to make any spiritual advancement. This is Karmakanda. So from here the yoga ladder begins. First was not acting as per scriptures. Scriptures say don't eat meat, we are eating meat. Scriptures saying don't intoxicate, we are intoxicating. Scriptures saying don't have illicit sexual relationships, we are having. Scriptures are saying don't gamble, we are gambling. So that is not a part of yoga ladder. Now we are avoiding these things. Why? So that we will go to Swarga. So this is the first step in yoga. So some people, they do yajna, for example, Drupad did yajna, Drupad. So Drupad, he did yajna to kill Dronacharya. So that is Karmakanda. You know, some people do something to get some result. Do something, get some result. Okay? So some people do some yajna to get money. So this is all Karmakanda. You know, if I do this, I will get higher status of life. If I do this, I'll go to Swarga. If I do this, I will get this. You know, do this activity, then you will be happy in your life. So this is the first stage of yoga. But in this, there is no spiritual advancement. That's why the Vedas, they talk about these things only. So that's why in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Traigunya Vishya Vedo, Traigunyo Vishya Veda, Nistraigunya Bhavarjuna. The Vedas are full of activities or recommendation of activities which are in the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. O Arjuna, you become transcendental to the three aspects of the Vedas. Nistraigunya Bhavarjuna. Krishna says that. So the question is why? Why he has done this? Why in Vedas, Vedas is supposed to be all good. Why in Vedas all these activities are defined? Activities for going to heaven. And if ultimate purpose is, you know, aham eva vedesh sarvair aham eva vedyo. If the ultimate purpose of learning Vedas is to know Krishna, then why is Veda distracting us?
It's kind of a ladder. First you have to do this, then you can go register.
Okay, any other answer? Good, this answer is accepted. Any other answer? Okay, so I will stick to what Jitendra Prabhu says. He is saying this is a ladder. Why are we giving this rung of the ladder? Because people are not wanting to become spiritually advanced. There are so many people who will go to some temple, you know, do this vrata, that vrata. We are not against vratas, but what is your intention behind doing the vrata? Oh, I am doing so that my husband gets promotion. Oh, I am doing this so that I get a child. Oh, I am doing this, so this. So this is there. There is no desire to be spiritually advanced. Desire is to remain in the material world and be happy here. Which is it possible?
No.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you sure? Is it possible to be in the material world, sir? No idea? Chance is there?
Maybe.
Maybe. Okay. So, the idea is, see, just like liquor, we all know liquor or whiskey and rum and all these things are bad. But still the government has given some license to some shops, right? Why? Because there are people who drink it. Is there anyone who does not know that drinking cigarette is injurious to health? Is there anyone who came and told you, I'm suffering from cancer, nobody told me, after drinking cigarette, I'll get the cancer? Is there anyone? No. But still people do. So similarly, Vedas, see, if Vedas will not give such kind of recommendations, then what will people do? They will reject the Vedas. So the Vedas are very merciful. A person is drinking 10 cigarettes a day, so Vedas will recommend, okay, you drink only 5. If a person is drinking 5, then Vedas will recommend reduce it to 2. And if a person is drinking 2, the Vedas will recommend you stop it. So different people, Vedas will give different things. Okay?
This Karma Kanda, it is said that no desire to make any spiritual advancement. So does Veda prescribe that?
No. I mean, Vedas, they will prescribe. But Karma Kanda, basically, the idea is to do this and get a result. The realization of the self is not happening. The idea is to do this and become happy. If I do this kind of austerity, then maybe in my next life I'll become a king.
So this is the outcome of
karma. Karma kand never leads to liberation. Karma kand never leads to self real. Purification happens. You know.
She is asking, Prabhu, in Vedas, is it not means spiritual advancement is not?
That's why Krishna is saying to Arjuna that Traigunyo Vishya Veda. The Vedas are full with activities in the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. Nistrai Gunya Bhavarjuna. You become transcendental.
The transcendental activities are not there in the Vedas.
Not much. Whole Vedas are simply full of we do this, we do that, we do this, we do that. To bring people to the realization of God. But direct, it's very difficult. If somebody simply reads the Vedas, they'll be very, very confused. That's why Krishna is saying Nistrai Gunya Bhavarjuna. Veda have been written for that purpose only, how to live their life.
Yeah.
Veda means knowledge. It has like Bhagavad Gita and Veda are not equivalent. Okay, Veda means knowledge. Suppose somebody wants to understand how to make aeroplanes. So that knowledge is there in the Vedas. Ayurveda, that is there in the Vedas. Military science, that is there in the Vedas. So by reading military science, Ayurveda, or how to make aeroplanes, will you go back home back to Godhead? Will any spiritual, for example, you are an engineer. After reading engineering, did you get any spiritual advancement in your life? So Vedas is like that.
It's a scope of living.
Scope of living, yeah. Very, the transcendental subject matters are there in the Vedas, but not so much. It ends at mode of goodness mostly. It is a huge, first of all, nobody knows what Vedas are. It is every branch of knowledge and any kind of knowledge which exists in this universe, it comes from Vedas.
And then Veda has been told by Brahma, I think.
Brahma was the first person who understood the Vedas, and that was told to him by Krishna when the primary creation was happening. The first shloka of Bhagavatam 1.1.1, Tene Brahma Adikavaye. So in the heart of Brahma, Krishna gave this knowledge of Vedas. And Veda studied, and Krishna, Brahma studied the Vedas 3 times. The whole Veda. That means every kind of knowledge which exists in this world, in this universe, Brahma already knows it. And he has studied it 3 times. So imagine what kind of a personality he is. Okay. But still he also comes in illusion sometimes. Yes.
Here Krishna says Arjuna to fight in the shloka.
I'm coming to it. Which is not the highest understanding, but Krishna, see, Krishna is taking Arjuna step by step. Okay, ye nahi to at least ye kar lo, ye nahi to at least ye kar lo. If not this, then at least do this. Like that he is talking. Okay. But the good thing about Karma Kanda is there is tendency to follow the scriptures. In the previous example we saw, they are like, we'll not follow the scriptures. But the good thing here is that some obedience is there. Scriptures has told that on Ekadashi we should fast, so we should fast. Why we are fasting, I don't know. It has told that if I fast, I'll become a king in my next lifetime. I will do it. But at least I'm following the scriptures. Okay? So people who are karmakandic, they, karmakanda people, you will see, you know, they will not be in, look, they are not in looking out, they are not looking out for God basically. They are just looking out how to be happy in the material world, which is ultimately not possible. Okay? That is the nature of these karma kandas. But this is a good engagement. It is better than not following the scriptures. So it's like someone wants money. So two ways are there. Either you go and loot a bank or else you find a job. So looting a bank is like not following the Vedas, and finding a job is like following the Vedas. Be doing karma kanda. Some engagement is there. Ghar mein baithke kya karein? Chalo job karte hain. Either you loot a bank or you do a job. Which is better?
Doing a job.
Doing a job.
Yeah.
I don't have a job also. Theek hai. This is Karma Kanda, okay? Till now everything is clear?
Yes.
Now we are coming. On the other hand, if a sincere person tries to control the active senses by the mind and begins Karma Yoga without attachment, he is by far superior. Now Krishna is, you know, he's like, although all, despite Arjuna is confused, he's like telling, first he told fight, then he says Karma Kanda, then he says, now we are talking about Karma Yoga basically. So he says, if a sincere person tries to control the active senses by the mind and begins Karma Yoga in Krishna consciousness without attachment, he is by far superior. So this is the concept of Karma Yoga. What is happening in Karma Yoga? If he tries to control the active senses by mind and begins Karma Yoga in Krishna consciousness. So mind control aspect is coming, and we have to do this without attachment to what?
Yes.
To results.
Yes.
So which is that very famous shloka about Karma Yoga?
Karma Nevadvarasya.
Yes, please continue.
Ma phaleshu padachanam, ma karma phalahitabhu, ma te samoskarmani.
Everybody knows this shloka. What is the meaning of this shloka, Mataji? Karte hi raho. Okay.
Roots of action.
Okay.
But do your duty.
Do your duty. So not doing duty is bad. Do your duty, but see, I'll read the exact translation. It says, you have a right to perform your prescribed duty, but you're not entitled to the fruits of the action. Never consider yourself to be the cause of the results of your activities, and never be attached to not doing your duty. So this is a very, very famous shloka which Mataji said. So this is basically, don't become attached to the results, because the results belong to the, to whom the results belong to?
Krishna.
Why? Can someone give an example? Sab kaam maine kiya, paisa maine kamaya, ghar maine banaya, ab ghar mein Krishna ko de do. Aisa kaise hoga baba?
God has given energy and everything.
Correct. Yeah. For example, I think I have given this example in previous sessions, filing a patent. How many of you have ambition to file a patent? After filing the patent, whom will the money and the business and the patent go to?
Organization.
Batao. Everything you did, ultimately, laddu koi aur khayega. Why? Because the company gives you salary, the company gives you the resources, the company gives you the time, at least in the worksheet. You know, time sheet, you fill 3 hours I spent on patent work. and the company gives you motivation, the company gives you, then everything company is giving. So when you do something, it belongs to the company. So similarly,
but when we file patent, we also get some perks.
50,000 rupees you will get, that's all.
Whatever.
And the 5 crore business which the company will get, that company will keep. It is like, come on, 50,000, for that you have given 1 year of your life working hard, even at home, working on the patent. And ultimately, you cannot even claim that it is yours. Why? Because it belongs to the company. Similarly, you have a right to do your duty. Why? Because Krishna is giving this air, this light, these, you know, different entities, earth, air, water, fire, ether, everything. So you have a right, you have to do this. But you cannot claim on the results. This is the basic aspect of karma yoga. Okay? So in this we are seeing that some aspect of detachment is coming. Correct? Earlier we saw don't follow the scriptures. Then we saw karma kanda means follow the scriptures. Be attached. Like I want to become a king in the next lifetime, so I will do this vrata. Now we came little bit detachment. Do the work, but don't claim on the results. Moving on. Do thou fight for the sake of fighting without considering happiness or distress, loss or gain, victory and defeat, and by doing so you shall never incur sin. So again, basically to some level of detachment is there. Previously Krishna was telling if you will fight, you will go to heaven. Now he is telling just fight for the sake of fighting. Don't worry about the results. So everybody needs a carrot, right? To go ahead in life. Some carrot is needed. So first, which carrot did Arjuna get from Krishna? Heaven carrot. Now he is telling, carrot has changed. Now what is the carrot? What is the carrot? You will not incur any sin by fighting just for the sake of fighting. And don't be attached. Fight with detachment. So, be detached from the results of action. So, this is the first rung after karma kand comes karma yoga. So, this is the second rung of the ladder. And it's a very, very important juncture in the yoga ladder. Imagine how happy you will become simply by following this one principle. Not thinking about happiness or distress. This takes a lot, you know. These are, while reading, it appears very simple. Let's say you are a policeman and you come to know that your own brother or your own son has done a crime. How much happy you will be to put that person in jail. But still you should do. That is karma yoga. Loss or gain. You have come to know that if you take this decision, as per ethics, as per morals, you should take this decision. But if you take this decision, then a big loss will come to you. But still you are doing it. That is karma yoga. Similarly, victory or defeat. You know that you are a soldier, you know that only two of you are there, and in front of you 20 people from the enemy party is there. You will know that you will definitely be killed, but still you are doing your duty. That is karma yoga. It's easy to work when we know that we are getting victory. It's easy to work when we know that we are getting gain or happiness. But doing the work despite gain or loss, despite happiness or distress, despite victory or defeat, that is karma yoga. And again, detachment has to be there. It's not like when I got victory, I opened my t-shirt and I threw it out just like See, Mataji only saying, I am not saying. So that is not Karma Yoga. What Saurav Ganguly is doing is, that is not Karma Yoga. Okay. So basically my job is to do my duty. Some people get frustrated from so much long I am trying to chant, but I am not getting focus in chanting. So let me stop chanting. That is not Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga means, no matter what happens, I will chant. Let the success in chanting come whenever it has to come. Okay? So basically, those who work for success, they don't get success. But those who work for a cause or for a higher goal in life, success runs behind them. You have to find a higher goal. Success can never be a goal. These days, corporates, they work like, okay, we want this much margin, we want this much turnover, so let's work for it. Very rarely they make it. Success should be a higher goal, which is beyond profits and loss, beyond happiness and distress. So the best goal is to go back home, back to Godhead. So with this goal, if you work, you know, then all this automatically will become detached. Whether somebody gives you 5 crore or somebody gives you 5 rupees, you are least bothered. Because your goal is very, very high. You want to achieve the lotus feet of Sri Krishna. With that goal, if you work, then you will become a yogi. You will surpass Karma Yoga immediately. Does it make sense? Always remember, there is a very, very nice book which I will refer, which I will like, maybe if you have time, you can refer. There is a book, it's called as Man's Search for Happiness. You know, it's a book written by one of the survivors of the Holocaust camp of Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler used to, you know, bring in concentration camps where he used to fill people and he used to torture them to death. So there he has written that all those people who did not have a higher goal in life, they voluntarily died. They went and touched some electric wire, or they ate poison on their own, or they just jumped out of the, because that condition was so, you know, that situation was so bad that 50 people were there, maybe in this small room, and food was not being given for 15 days. So people used to pass stool and they used to eat their own stool. That was the situation in the Holocaust camp. So there, nobody survived. Only those people who had a higher goal in life, which is beyond themselves, like not just related to them, only those people who had some mission, some higher goal, they escaped or somehow they survived. So if you want to survive in this material world, have a higher goal. Don't have a goal like, I want to get a promotion, or I want to, you know, go to Australia, I want to see a kangaroo. These kind of goals will not work. Try to see who has made the kangaroo rather than who's, you know. By the way, kangaroo has a pocket in which it keeps the young one. Man's Search for Happiness. It's a good book, recommended. Very nice. Many, many psychologists, psychiatrists, they refer that. Okay. So, Karma Yoga, to summarize, a little detachment from results of one's actions is exhibited here, like we have discussed here. Now, it is again, Karma Yoga can again be divided into two categories. Sakam Karma Yoga, Nishkam Karma Yoga. Sakam means attached to the work and also attached to the results of the work. But what he will do, a person, he likes doing the work. Okay? But he also wants the results of the work. But since he is a Karma Yogi, so what he will do? Some part of the result he will go and sacrifice. Like, he will go and do some social charity, or maybe he will go in a temple and he will put in the hundi. Something he will do. So this is the first class of Karma Yogi. First type of Karma Yogi, that is Sakama Karma Yogi. Please remember, he is attached to work also, attached to results also, but he has the desire to give some portion. He understands that the person who is giving the results is Krishna, so something should go back. This much, but he cannot, he is attached to the results. No? If he is getting something, he can give only 10%. 90% he wants to keep with him. That is also good. It is better than the Karma Kanda people who don't want to give anything. 10% he is ready to give. That is Sakama Karma Yogi. Nishkama Karma Yogi means no attachment to the result. They are just attached to the work. Please take note that I am talking about detachment, but still, despite having the detachment from the result, they are still attached to do the work. Does it make sense? Fully confused? Am I going too fast?
No, no.
Okay, see, we are talking about detachment, but here the detachment has come partially. In Nishkam Karma Yoga, which is better than Sakam Karma Yoga, in Sakam Karma Yoga, they are attached to what? Work as well as results. But some part of the result they are ready to give away as social charity or as need not be God. There are so many people, you know, who do work and just do some social charity. They'll give it to some university or some hospital, cancer research, or they'll make a hospital or something they will do. So that is Sakam Karma Yoga. Okay, Nishkam Karma Yoga means that person is little bit is higher than Sakam Karma Yogi. He is telling that I am just attached to my work. I don't care for the results. Sakam Karma Yogi is giving 10%, but Nishkam Karma Yogi will give away 100%.
Is he attached to the work or is
attached to the work only?
Just doing the work what he's supposed to do.
That is attachment. No. Without the work, he cannot live.
No, that's not the question. Attached to the work, or he just doing the work what he is supposed to do?
Attached. For example,
what is the difference?
Difference.
No, my question
what
is,
what she is asking, what is the difference?
The difference
just
is
just doing and attaching
no.
into the work.
So, like, let's say my daughter comes and asks me for something.
Mm.
So, I do the work, I just like she has asked me to come and do some nice project work. So, I'm bound to do that, I've given the project work, not taking any credit, just give it and it and given it to her. So,
I'll try to explain with this example only. A mother tries to help the child. Okay. Does the mother want something in return? Many mothers they want.
No.
I'm sorry, but the reality is that many mothers they want. In my counseling sessions, I have come to know, Kali Yuga. Okay, so some mothers they want, so little bit they will let go, but something, and there are some mothers who don't want, they simply want to serve the child, but without the child they will not be able to live. So this is Nishkam Karma Yoga.
If I would replace my daughter with my neighbor's daughter, then also I would do the same thing, that is Nishkam Karma.
No, that is higher than Nishkam Karma Yoga. That means you are not attached to your daughter, you just want to. See, basically a painter, let me give another example. A painter is there, he's painting. He's so absorbed in painting, he doesn't care whether his painting is being sold for 2 rupees or 20 lakh rupees. If 2 rupees comes, he gives it. If 2 lakh comes, he gives it. But he cannot live without painting. That is attachment. True detachment means, today he's painting, tomorrow, Prabhuji, from tomorrow you'll cook. Okay, Prabhuji. That is true detachment. Somehow or the other, I have to be engaged in the service of the Lord. Whatever service you give me. But if you say, hey, Prabhuji, from last 5 years, I have been doing accounts only. I want account service only. This is attachment. Now, does it make sense? Nishkam Karma Yoga also has level of attachment. But they are not attached to the results. They don't care how much result is coming. They are just attached to the work. Without work, they will not be able to live.
You can say passionate with them.
If they are passionate about doing work and they are in the mode of goodness enough to give away the entire result, generally passionate people do not give up the result because they are working for result only. Nishkam Karma Yoga means mode of goodness. Work inspires them. The quality of work inspires them. The result doesn't inspire them. Now, even if nobody is seeing, they will do their work nicely. That is Nishkam Karma Yoga.
Mm. So, painting is his passion, suppose.
Okay.
So, in that case, that is also Nishkam.
No, if it is his passion, he will want money for it.
Okay.
If he finds a reason to be happy by doing painting, that is mode of goodness. So, he just wants to be happy. Whether somebody is giving him 50 lakhs or somebody is not giving anything, he will continue painting. But without painting, you take out his paintbrush, he will die in 2 minutes. Does it make sense to you? That is Nishkam Karma Yoga. Yes. They are working for their own pleasure, not for the pleasure of God. Does it make sense? They are working for the gratification of their own senses, but not for the senses of the Supreme Lord. That is Nishkam Karma Yoga. But you please understand, this Nishkam Karma Yoga is a very, very high concept. And it is very, imagine somebody is just working for the sake, they are finding all their happiness, Atmaram nature, they are finding happiness within themselves only. It's not easy, but not for God. It's not the highest form of yoga. Okay.
Let's say a devotee. Let's say a devotee. So probably a normal one who is not a Vaishnava, after fulfilling his duties, serving his family.
Devotee of whom? If not a Vaishnava, then devotee of whom?
I'll not put as devotee, a householder.
Pious man. Okay.
A householder.
Okay.
A householder, after serving the family and taking off the duties, I mean doing work, and after retiring at the age of 50 or 60, where he cannot travel or something, wherein he sits and he does his japa. Probably at that time, 50 years, he started doing japa after taking.
Very difficult that he can start at that time, and very difficult that he'll be able to do anything at that time. But okay.
So then he starts. Let's say at least he started his bhakti at that time, 50 years. So the person cannot move, and the person is sitting and he does his japa. So that is Nishkam Karma, because he is not attached, but he is simply doing his japa. So not attached to results, not.
No, first of all, he cannot produce any results. No, there's no question. So, see, this person becoming useless and then picking up bhakti, this will not fall in Nishkam Karma Yoga. He's not doing it for the pleasure of the Lord. He's doing it because he cannot do anything else. Probably he's doing this because his parents or his son or daughter or whoever family members have said, you do this. So he's just doing this so that he can get 3 times meals in a day. See, whatever, once your body becomes useless, you cannot please the Lord, because the desires will be there. Body is not cooperating, frustration will be there. In this frustration, how can you do Nishkam Karma Yoga? Nishkam Karma Yoga is a very, very high concept. You cannot do Sakam Karma Yoga also. You cannot be a Karma Yogi in that situation.
So, we have to give bodily attachment to be Nishkam Karma Yoga.
I am not understanding. Bodily attachment.
So, to
do bhakti, your body should be working, first of all. If we think that at the age of 70, when my lungs are not working, hands are not working, eyes are not working, I'll start doing bhakti, very difficult. Very, very difficult. Prabhupada, once one of the disciples of Prabhupada, she asked, see, my son is 1 year old. When do you think I should start telling him to do japa? So Prabhupada said, how many years old he is? She said, 1 year old. Prabhupada said, you are already 2 years late. Japa should have started when he was in womb only. Indian society, there is a big confusion about this yoga concept. Especially this giving up thing. And people say, oh, if I give up everything, if I give up all the results, if I give up all, how will I survive? Then there is a shloka in Bhagavad Gita which says, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam. No, not in Bhagavad Gita. This is in Katha Upanishad. Eko hi bahunam yo vidhati kaman. So we are also person, God is also a person, he is also living entity, and we are also living entity. So the difference between God and us is that God is maintaining everybody. Eko hi bahunam yo vidhati kaman. People think that our salary is our source of maintenance, our family is our source of maintenance. That old man example which Shrisha Mataji is giving, he will think that my family members are maintaining me, but ultimately Krishna is maintaining everybody. So this realization should come. That is real yoga. Otherwise we will be stuck in Karma Yoga. We will never be able to go higher than Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is not the highest part of the ladder, by the way. Nishkam Karma, people say, oh, Nishkam Karma Yoga is the highest. Kaam karo, do not be attached to the results. That's the best thing which you can do. Hare Krishna, that is not the best thing you can do. This is not the word the Bhagavad Gita teaches. Okay?
So, Karma Yoga is basically about the worldly activities we do. it's not about our actually surrendering the result onto the God, right? So
see, if let's say if you have the tendency to submit, let's say you made 1 lakh rupees and you have a desire to give away 10,000 from that, that is like you're giving 10,000 to God. So the God aspect is here. We cannot say that Karma Yoga does not contain any aspect of God consciousness. It contains, but attachments is there to the rest 90%. That's why it is said sometimes Krishna does not see what you are giving, he sees what you are keeping back. Okay. Because ultimately you will cannot take anything with you. Okay, am I going too fast? Is it too technical? Is everybody following?
Yes.
This session is technical, but are you able to understand till now?
And sorry.
Yeah, you have come late. That's why you're not understanding.
No, no.
Yeah.
I understood.
Okay.
So, but for a householder, so he should be doing. He cannot do anyways nishkam karma at.
So the solution will come in the later stages. Just hang on. I'll give you solution for householders. Just wait for 15-20 slides. It'll come. So we understood what is outside the scriptures. We understood what is Karma Kand. With Karma Kand, tendency to follow scriptures comes. And then comes Karma Yoga, which is higher than Karma Kand, where people are looking for spiritual advancement with along with some detachment. And in that also there are various degrees of detachment. One is being attached to the work and detached to results, that is Nishkam. And lower than that is Sakam, attached to results also, attached to work also, but some portion of results I will give. Understood? Okay. Now, we will discuss about Gyan Yoga. All created beings are unmanifest in the beginning, manifest in the interim state, and unmanifest again when annihilated. So what is the need for lamentation? Gyan Yoga is basically yoga by analysis. Not so much work here. Simply they will think and reason. Okay, like we are discussing what is Brahman, what is Paramatma, what is Bhagwan. This is analysis. That is Gyan Yoga. So people can say, how can this thought process or simply sitting in one place and thinking be yoga? Yoga needs some body movement, some work, some engagement. But this is, and that too people can challenge that, how can this be higher than Karma Yoga? See, engagement does not simply mean physical. If somebody's mind is nicely engaged, he is very happy. Okay. Analysis also breaks attachment. If somebody is successfully able to analyze, see, I am wasting so much of my time drinking cigarette. By drinking cigarette, first of all, I am wasting so much money, I am wasting so much time, my health is going. If by this analysis, if he is able to give up cigarette, isn't that better than the previous discussions or the previous ladders of yoga? Earlier, he is doing something to be detached from something. Now, without doing also, if just by analysis, if he can get it, that's higher. That's called as Gyan Yoga. So, gradual movement towards inaction is recommended in Gyan Yoga. Movement towards inaction, cessation of work. Focus more on the mental plane. Think, analyze, logically reason it out. Sankhya Yoga. You know, you understand what is Gyan Yoga. Analyze what is the nature of the soul, what is the nature of the body, you know, unnecessary attachments. See, a person who does not understand the attachment to the body, he will be entangled in Karma Kanda, or to say in Karma Yoga also. But a person who understands that the attachment to body is wrong, and ultimately by taking care of so many things which are related to the body, ultimately the body will not be there, nothing will be there. If he is ready to, if he is able to come out of that misery, he is better, right? Are you all agree?
Yes.
So Gyan Yoga, is it higher than Karma Yoga?
Yes.
Are you convinced?
Yes.
In pressure or happily?
But
not convinced. Yes, ask.
So
yeah.
So in Gita, at one point of time, Krishna only says that you do your whatever duty,
yeah,
prescribed duty.
So Krishna is giving various examples. See, first he told you fight so that you'll go to heaven. Then he is saying, you fight because that is the right thing to do. Now he is recommending inaction. So Krishna is giving various things. Later on, Arjuna only asks that first you tell me to fight, then you tell me that intelligence is better than fighting. You please tell me clearly what you want me to do. He asks the same question. Krishna gives answer to that also. So just hang on.
Prabhu, what is this meaning? Manifest in their interim state.
Yeah.
In the sense, all created beings are unmanifest in the beginning.
And you understood that? Unmanifest in what does that mean?
Means nothing is there.
Avyakta.
Shunya, probably shunya.
Shunya. How can soul be in shunya?
Not shunya, probably we've been.
Okay, chalo. For now I agree. Chalo.
Or not manifested.
Not manifested. Okay. After that, in interim state means?
Which state is it referring to?
Interim state is this state. They are manifest. We are manifest. This is interim state. And then unmanifest when we are annihilated.
Okay.
First we are not, as per your definition, which is a good definition. First we are not there, then we are there, then again after annihilation we will not be there. Now the question is where we will go, that is a detailed discussion.
But there. We'll come back again. So what is the thing of not...
There is something called as Mahat Tattva, second canto Bhagavatam. It talks about how the sum total of all material energy is there in Mahat Tattva. All the souls, they reside in the body of Mahavishnu. When Mahavishnu glances at the Mahat Tattva with his glance, that glance carries the souls. Just by his glance, the whole universe starts. Everything starts. So that glance is called as Shambhu, or that glance represents Lord Shiva. So with that glance, so many souls will come into the material nature, and when those that glance will fall on material nature, she will get agitated and 8.4 million varieties of life will come. Does this make sense? That is what is said in Srimad Bhagavatam. So unmanifest means Mahat Tattva stage, manifest means present stage, unmanifest means again Mahat Tattva stage. Okay? So Gyan Yoga is yoga by analysis, and
what is Sankhya Yoga? Prabhu, you used that word Sankhya.
Yeah, Sankhya Yoga is logically understanding the difference between body and soul. That is called Sankhya Yoga.
It's different than...
It's a part of Gyan Yoga only.
Sankhya is something like about numbers or something?
No, nothing.
Sankhya.
No, Sankhya.
Sankhya, because I thought...
In fact, numbers are a part of Sankhya Yoga. You have to count how many lifetimes I have spent in different bodies. So that is Sankhya Yoga. I'm just kidding. So Sankhya Yoga is the discussion which has happened between Lord Kapila and his mother Devahuti. Third canto, Srimad Bhagavatam, chapter 20 to 29. Okay, so you can refer it. So analysis, I'll give you an example. Everybody is looking for happiness. When you are doing sinful activities, you are looking for happiness. When you are doing Karma Kanda, you are looking for happiness. Even when you are doing Karma Yoga, you are basically looking for some... Yeah.
So, you said you are doing sinful act. Everybody is doing. But what if one person is attached to the pleasure or sensation getting from the sinful act? He doesn't want to. Let's say I'm on a diet and I want to become healthy. And I want to give up some junk food. Or some...
So, this part you missed in the previous session. I mean, in the previous part of the presentation. I was discussing the yoga ladder, and the first discussion which I did is sinful activities. Sinful activities are not a part of the yoga ladder. So there is a category of people who do not follow the scriptures. The scriptures say, do not eat too much, do not eat too less. Do not sleep too much, do not sleep too less. But we do not follow that.
No, I understand about it. But the question is, I'm attached to that craving what I'm getting. I'm attached, I want to leave that food. I want to become healthy. I'm doing everything. I'm doing running exercise. But everybody who are, let's say, doing the sinful activities, they want to leave the sinful activities. The example what you gave, person who is smoking or drinking, or they want to leave that habit. But they're attached to that craving or pleasure or something what they're getting.
Okay.
So in that case, how this thing is going to help them to just by saying that nishkama or the sakama, the person cannot leave it. So is the chanting only the way?
No, in that case Vedas are there, no? If he is smoking, like we discussed, if he is smoking 10, then we should recommend him to drink 5 cigarettes. If he is drinking 5, then we'll recommend him to 2. If he is drinking 2, then we'll recommend him, okay, you do not drink, you take some tablets, like that. This kind of recommendations are there. So, the reason why someone is forced to do this is lust. We have discussed in previous sessions. Arjuna is also asking. People don't want to do sins, but they are forced to do sins. That is the lust. So in such cases, that person needs external counseling. That person needs help from outside. That person needs to have a determination. You know, he has to take a resolve that I will give up. And he has to be honestly and sincerely trying to do it. And of course, chanting helps. Chanting helps in mind control. So when his mind will become controlled, he'll be able to say no to the lusty desires. Do you know what is lust? Lust, highest definition of lust is doing some activities for the pleasure of my own senses is lust. But when we do activities for the pleasure of the senses of Krishna, that is love. That is only love. There is no other kind of love which is available. If someone says, this is my girlfriend, from last 20 years I have been together with her, that is not love. Love means doing activities for the pleasure of the Lord. Lord is also having senses. You know, Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam. You try to please the senses of the Lord, that is love. But when I'm trying to please my senses, I want a big house. For whom? For me only. I want a big car. For whom? For me only. I want to go to, you know, this island and buy it and be there. What? I'll do my... This is all lust. Lust does not generally means the attraction. That is the grossest form of lust, or the highest form of lust is attraction between the opposite genders. Because the whole world is moving on that. But a broader definition of lust is doing things for my own happiness. So because of that, a person is forced, like Mataji is giving example, somebody wants to give a burger, but he is attached so much to that taste of burger, so he will suffer. Unlimitedly he will suffer. Birth after birth he will suffer. And slowly and steadily Krishna, because of that lusty tendency, he will start doing sinful activities and he will be put into demonic species of life. This is the problem if mind is not controlled. Mind control is not an option. Those who are thinking that my mind is not controlled, what to do, I'll just live with it, just wait for some time. You'll not even get a human body next time. So we have to say no to lust, say no to the mind. Chant the Hare Krishna Mahamantra and control it. 16th chapter Bhagavad Gita, divine and demonic natures. Yes.
In Gita only Krishna says your mind is very difficult to control. You can control the wind, you can control.
Krishna doesn't say, Arjuna says.
Arjuna says anything. But that is the only difficult thing to control.
No. Krishna says, no, with practice and detachment, you can control the mind. With suitable practice and detachment, he says. So what is that suitable practice? We have explained. It is the chanting of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, the ABCD. And detachment is the different kinds of yoga which we are discussing. Everything, you are convinced? Any other questions? Can we move to the next form of yoga? Okay. So see, Arjuna is being convinced that you need not be sorry if you kill your grandfather or if you kill your teacher. You know, because everything is unmanifest. Now it is manifest, again it will become unmanifest. This is called as Gyan Yoga. It is slowly going towards inaction. So Gyan Yoga says, when we perform action, there is chance of performing some mistakes, so better avoid action. This is the proposal of Gyan Yoga. Material action is performed by 3 modes of nature, so why do any action? 2 things that are encouraged are knowledge and analysis based on that, and inaction. Okay, so I'll give you 2 examples. How many of you have seen a movie where the hero is killing many people?
All of us.
And how many of you have seen a detective movie where the detective is not killing anyone but just simply thinking and trying to solve? Which one is better?
Detective.
Why?
That is
Karma Yoga, and Gyan Yoga is higher. Similarly, Sherlock Holmes. How many of you have seen Sherlock Holmes or read Sherlock Holmes?
Red.
Simply that guy keeps thinking.
Yes.
he sits in one place and simply keeps thinking. But the level of happiness which he achieves is quite commendable. You know, I have seen one person, there is a very, very big library in London. So many books are there. I used to see one person, he would sit there at 6 o'clock in the morning, not nicely dressed, hair and all not combed, face not so very clean. And he will sit there, read books until night 10 o'clock, the librarian has to throw him out. Then only he will go. And then again 6 o'clock in the morning he will come. You cannot imagine the level of pleasure which he is experiencing. A karma yogi cannot even imagine that kind of pleasure. In fact, the scriptures say when you go in the higher planetary systems, the pleasures keep becoming subtle. Karma yogi or karma kandis, they are getting happiness, but that is all gross happiness. But subtle happiness means happiness at the level of mind and intelligence. For example, if you go to the higher planetary system, there is a place called as Gandharva Lok. So there, happiness is just sound. They will sing nicely, they will create nice musical symphonies, and that is their happiness. When they see earthly people running behind sex and money, they think that, what these people? They don't know what real happiness is. Because the real happiness lies in sound for them. They can just survive for thousands and thousands of years just focusing on that tune and the sound aspect. Even higher than Gandharva Loka is the Swarga Loka. Even higher than that is Jana Loka, Maha Loka, and highest is Brahma Loka. Brahma Loka is purely intelligence. Simply one thought, and by that thought they will be completely blissful. That is Jnana Yoga. That can give you so much kick, that can give you so much so-called seeming happiness that you will forget about doing anything else. Simply you will sit in one place and keep thinking. That will give you many, many things. That is called as Jnana Yoga.
But without doing the work, can we go in Jnana Yoga?
Yeah, yeah. There are so many people. So many people. Simply if you give them some topic, that's where that concept of Muni comes. Muni means somebody who is doing constant manan. You give him one thing, then he will tell you, okay, this can be seen in 56 different angles. The Lord is also a Jnana Yogi to some, I mean not completely a Jnana Yogi, but he, Jnana Yoga comes from the Lord. For example, Lord Chaitanya, when he was having a discussion with Keshav Kashmiri, with whom did Lord Chaitanya have this Atmaram discussion? With the Mayavadi sannyasis in Benares, Prakashanand Saraswati and others. So the Lord defined the word Atmaram in 64 different ways. Do you think that is not Jnana Yoga? Was the Lord doing any work when he was defining? He was simply sitting and see, Atmaram means this also. Atmaram means this also. Atmaram means this also. This is a very, very high activity. Correct? Please correct me if I am wrong.
But we should be in that mode to be in that mode.
So Jnana Yoga is not easy. Not everybody can do. It's not a child's play. One who has performed Nishkam Karma Yoga successfully, only he can elevate himself to Jnana Yoga. It's not easy. Somebody who is attached to his, his gun, how can he do Jnana Yoga? Jnana Yoga is not easy, but there are so many Jnana Yogis in the world. Scientists, they will take, or mathematicians, they will take one small problem. 20 years they are working on the same problem. That is Jnana Yoga. They don't do anything, they simply go, they take a piece of paper, they sit. Think, they die. They're not able to solve the problem. But that is Jnana Yoga to some extent. Of course, what Jnana they are working on, that is also important. Somebody is working on Bhagavad Gita and somebody is working on, something else, some design of some building. Yeah? So that is difference. Okay, for one who is a neophyte in the eightfold yoga system, work is said to be the means. And for one who is already elevated in yoga, cessation of all material activity is said to be the means. This is what Krishna says. One who is new, neophyte means new, engage them. Okay, how to engage? No. Work. He has to start doing Karma Yoga. Eightfold Yoga system is something else, not Navavidhi. That is nine. This is eight. Eightfold Yoga system. So one who is a newcomer in the Eightfold Yoga system. Eightfold Yoga system is now coming to Dhyan Yoga. So those who are new. Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama. I'll come to it. So after Karma Yoga comes Gyan Yoga, and after Gyan Yoga comes Dhyan Yoga. So Lord is saying those who are very new to Dhyan Yoga, what they should do? They should do Karma Yoga. And one who are already elevated in Karma Yoga, okay, they should stop everything and they should start doing Gyan Yoga. Is it clear? Arurukshor Muner Yogam Karma Karanam Uchyate Yoga Rudhasya Tasyaiva Samah Karanam Uchyate. Those who are new, they should do Karma Yoga. Those who are advanced, in many, many lifetimes, they have perfected their Karma Yoga. Now they should do Gyan Yoga. Okay? So gradual movement towards, see, Yoga Rudukshu means beginners in Yoga, and Yoga Rudha means perfected yogis. So Yoga Rudukshu, what they should do? Karma Karanam Uchyate. And Yoga Rudhasya, who are perfect, what they should do? Samah Karanam Uchyate. They should focus more on the jnana and the dhyana aspect. Okay? That is the gradual development. For example, a person who is joining a company very new, he will be giving all that physical work. But when he spends 50 years in the company, he will just sit in one place and keep thinking the strategies, the vision. You know? And he will be paid more money for just sitting in one place. Does it make sense now? So Gyan Yoga is higher, Dhyan Yoga is higher. Moving on. So now I'll tell you how to do Dhyan Yoga. Who can read this for me? Maybe Nagi can read this.
To practice yoga, one should go to a scheduled place.
Secluded place.
And should lay pusha grass on the ground and then cover it with a
deer skin
and a soft cloth.
Okay.
The seat should be neither too high nor too low and should be situated in a sacred place. The yogi should then sit on it very firmly and then practice yoga to purify the heart by controlling his mind, senses and activities and fixing the mind on one point.
How many of you can do this?
Sitting is okay, controlling mind is
not okay. Sitting is also not okay. First of all, you have to go and see. Sitting means not at home. Sitting means, please understand, sitting means not at home. First of all, give up your home, go to some secluded place where nobody else will come. Signal will also not come. Mobile, okay. And then how to sit? Not too high, not too low, and then find a deer skin also. And then after that a soft cloth also. Now people will say, why Krishna is recommending to kill a deer? Who was about to ask this question? You only?
In my mind, but I didn't think.
Why you were not asking? See, you should always ask.
Don't. Deer skin at that time would make them warm. At that time?
Now it's no longer giving warm.
Because it's not allowed to use deer skin.
See, first of all, you have to understand, this is, we are talking about Gyan Yogis. Then, and simply sitting and not doing any work. Do you think a Gyan Yogi or Dhyan Yogi will take the trouble to go and kill a deer and take out the deer skin? That also somebody else will do. And that too, there are so many deers who are dying every day. Somebody else will have to give them. They are not doing anything. Why will they go and kill a deer? So these yogis, they will never kill a deer. They will just get it from somewhere. So the idea of having, like, they are very, very, it's antibacterial and it avoids so many insects and other things, and many, many things are there. So Krishna is saying that means it is helpful, deer skin. We have seen so many, even till the last 300 years, we have seen so many, there are so many mathas are there in Karnataka, Suttur Math, this. Tiger skin, deer skin, all that they will wear. So it is helpful. And then soft cloth, and it should be neither too high, too low. And you have to sit very firmly, practice yoga, purify the heart.
What is the answer for that? That's why Krishna is recommending dear skin is to kill.
He's not killing.
He's not saying, but to get also somebody has to kill or something.
See, deer is anyways dying every day. So many deers are dying every day.
After how they are dying, somebody is killing.
See, whether you are a human being or a deer, the death rate is 100%. Human beings also die, similarly deers also. Don't think that every deer is shot only, like that black deer.
Okay, like that,
I think this has been given in Bhagavatam only, with the Vamana Vrittantam. There is saying why there is a, for a young, this thing, when he does that, why they put that shikha, why he puts that stick, why they wear that deer skin, I think it is given.
Okay. No, my question was not that why they...
Krishna is not recommending to kill. People naturally die. Take that.
Natural one. Okay.
So you have natural to. We have to appreciate this fact.
Yeah.
Gyan Yoga is already recommending you stop doing work.
Yeah.
Simply meditate. And such kind of people, they will never take the trouble to kill a deer. Please understand. They'll find a deer who is dead. They'll say someone thoda nikal ke de do. And that too also, if nobody is giving, they'll manage without that. If somebody is giving, they will take. That is their nature. But somebody will see he is struggling, so they will give. But Bhagavad Gita says it is good. So this is not possible. Even Arjuna said, I cannot do this. It says, refrain from all actions, sit in one place and fully focus the mind on the object of meditation. This is Dhyana Yoga. It's not possible. Sometimes this Dhyana Yoga is also called as Hatha Yoga or Ashtanga Yoga. And it has 8 parts. Yama, Niyama, Pratyahar, Dhyana, Dhyana, Samadhi. Okay. So what does Yama and Niyama means? Do's and don'ts. Many people, they say, oh, we are practicing Ashtanga Yoga. But after doing that 2-hour session, I'm going and eating all the nonsense. Yoga begins with do's and don'ts. Nobody can be a yogi. These days, yoga, this, first of all, they are not under explaining them what is Karma Yoga and what is Gyan Yoga. Directly, they are going to Ashtanga Yoga. That's okay. No problem. But after going also, they are not explaining that yoga means self-control. Yama. And yama means do's. Niyama means don't do's. Don'ts, basically. So don'ts means don't do this, 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 this. Do's means this, 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 this. Which yoga or so-called Ashtanga Yoga or Hatha Yoga Institute will tell you, if you do not wake up in the Brahma Murta, then don't come for our classes. Which Ashtanga Yoga or Hatha Yoga Institute will tell you, Power Yoga Institute will tell you, that if you do not stop eating chicken and if you do not, you know, you stop gambling and intoxication and have illicit relationships, you don't come to us. This shop will only close. So therefore they say, you do whatever you want. You be the way you, whatever you want. Just pay us this much money, come this much time, we'll give you certificate. So completely ignoring Yama and Niyama aspect. And they say we are yogis. Sometimes in the association of friends, you have to go to various places. So once I was walking on the road, on that road, a group of drunkards, they were coming. So somebody told, hey, see, this person, he is from India and all. So I was talking to him, he was like, yeah, you are from India, I also do a lot of yoga, you know. And he was like, smell of beer was coming from his mouth. He was about to fall down actually. And he was telling, I'm like a yoga teacher. And I was thinking, yeah, that's so nice of you. So this happens. Okay. Asana and pranayam, they are meant for what? Quick. Asana and pranayam, they are meant for what?
Mind and body.
Mind and body. Why do we need to control the mind and body to do yoga? Suppose you are trying to meditate on the Lord and your knee starts paining. How will you focus on the Lord? So this is very necessary. Asana and pranayam. Until unless your consciousness is so advanced that no matter what happens to your body, you are still able to think about the Lord. If your consciousness is not like that, then better do asana and pranayam. And then Dhyan, Dharana and Samadhi, they are progressive stages of meditation. Okay? So the degree to which you progress, to that degree, you will be able to be happy. If you can enter the samadhi stage where you are able to focus your mind on something for this much duration of time without anything else coming to your mind, that
this is samadhi. You don't have mind only, no? Your mind is absorbed into the, I mean, you don't like samadhi state is also like vidra stage wherein you don't know what is happening to you, like how you don't remember what is happening.
Why? Because you are focused on something. There is no nullism and voidism in samadhi. You do not become null, you do not become void. You become oblivious of your surroundings, what is around you, but there is a very, very strong meditation happening on some aspect.
Same with nidra state, where we are not nullified, we don't remember anything.
You call that a samadhi? Every day you go in samadhi for 6 hours?
No, I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
But how is it different from that?
See, samadhi means unbreaking chain of thought on something so that it is giving you indescribable bliss, and that chain of thought is not, it is giving you so much engagement that you don't want to do anything else also.
But when mind is only not there, how can I think in samadhi?
But where have you got this definition from?
No, because in samadhi, because you are so much absorbed into the object what you are meditating. Let's say if I take the sweet sugar or a salt or a salted this thing, I put it in the notion, it obviously melts. I mean, it goes. I cannot differentiate the salt with the sea. Similarly, if I'm meditating on something, I'll be absorbed into it. I don't have my senses. I don't have any this thing on my senses. So at that time, my mind will not be there. Obviously, my gross senses will not be working. So the same thing, I'm just comparing, how is it different from...
See, Bhagavad Gita says that never a time comes when you merge somewhere. The soul was existing, even Krishna gives an example to Arjuna that see these soldiers, they were existing before, they are existing now, and even in the future they will exist. So this salt example is not valid for soul and super soul.
Okay.
A soul will never lose its identity. Even when you go back home, back to Godhead, you will have your individuality. Your service is fixed. You are a person, you have a name, you have a form. So the Krishna or the Vaishnava understanding of samadhi, this what I think you are discussing is the Mayavada or the Nirvisheshvada understanding of samadhi. But the Vaishnava or the Bhagavad Gita understanding of samadhi is, Prabhupada used to say, if somebody is working from morning till night for Krishna, he is in samadhi. Because when he is working, he is not thinking anything else about Krishna or about other than the devotees of Krishna. No other single thought comes in his mind, and he is getting a lot of bliss, and that bliss cannot be described, and that is unbreaking. So he is in complete samadhi. It does not look, see, it may not look like this person who is going from one apartment to another apartment doing sankirtan and doing book distribution. It may look like he is just another person, but that person is in samadhi, complete samadhi, nirvikar samadhi. That is the Vaishnav way of understanding samadhi. Samadhi means, highest samadhi is complete absorption in the service of the Lord, complete absorption in the thoughts, naam, roop, gun and leela of the Lord. If I'm able to think about the Kaliya Krishna leela for 2 hours while talking and I'm not thinking anything else, that is samadhi for me. We have to understand that there is, as long as we have this body, okay, mind is there, and mind needs pleasure. And mind gets pleasure only when mind gets engaged in Krishna. If mind does not get engaged in a higher taste, it will look for a lower taste. Does it make sense? If mind is engaged in Krishna, mind will feel so happy. Anandam buddhivardhanam pratipadam purnamrita swadhanam. So mind also has to be engaged in Krishna. Body also has to be engaged in Krishna. Soul also has to be engaged in Krishna. This is my understanding of samadhi. So, fundamental understanding of samadhi is, you are able to focus on something, an object of meditation, you are able to focus on it in an unbreaking way, and it is giving you a lot of bliss. This is the fundamental level of understanding what is samadhi is. As long as we have a physical body, it is a little bit difficult to deny that mind is not there. When we have a spiritual body, that means the subtle body and the gross body is not there. But as long as we have a body, it's little bit difficult to deny that mind is not there, intelligence is not there, you know. Does it make sense? This is the Vaishnava understanding of Samadhi. Of course, I do not know much details. Maybe we can have a further discussion. But Prabhupada says in his letters and his books that somebody who is working for Krishna morning to night is in complete Samadhi. Complete Samadhi. That is the highest possible Samadhi. Whether he is a brahmachari or a householder or whoever. Suppose Deepak Prabhu goes for book distribution for 4 hours. So he has done 4 hours Samadhi and come. That is what Prabhupada says.
So in night while remember Krishna and sleep goes to sleep.
Before you go to sleep, 5 minutes you are in Samadhi when you are remembering Krishna. Once you go to sleep, definitely that is not Samadhi. Okay. But in your dream, if Jagannath comes or if Krishna comes, that is Samadhi. For that you have to read Krishna book before sleeping and take a glass of warm milk. Okay, moving on. Now comes, after Dhyan Yoga, Arjuna said it's very difficult. All of you said it's very difficult. No problem. Another offer Krishna is giving. See, Krishna's offers are also changing in Bhagavad Gita only. So you should understand what kind of a person he is. He is completely teda. First he will say you go to Swarga. Then he is saying you fight because that is your duty. Now he is saying you stop fighting because intelligence is higher than work. Then Arjuna says, tick tick batao. Tell me clearly. Otherwise I will not fight. Then he recommends Ashtang Yoga. Then to that Arjuna says, I cannot do Ashtang Yoga. Then he comes to Bhakti Yoga.
Giving different people to different
they can do. Yeah. See, Krishna is talking on an eternal time scale. He knows this Bhagavad Gita will be read by different people in different time scales. So not everybody will get attracted to Karma Yoga. Not everybody will get attracted. Krishna is so merciful, he gives options to everybody. But in this conversation, ultimately he comes to Bhakti Yoga to teach people that Bhakti Yoga is the highest. And therefore he says, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam Yome Bhaktya Prayachati Tada Aham Bhaktya Upahritam Ashnami. Very nice. So doing the Lord, doing things for the Lord's satisfaction. This is Bhakti Yoga. Is it simple? Is it easy?
Yes.
Is it like Ashtang Yoga?
No.
So, Yad Karosi, Yad Ashnasi, Yad Juhosi, Dadasi, Yad, Yad Tapasyasya Kaunteya, Tat Kurushva Mad Arpanam. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever you offer or give away, and whatever austerities you perform, do that, O son of Kunti, as an offering to me. Now you please understand why Krishna told Karma Yoga before. Because he wants to give this independence to the living entity. If Krishna would have directly come and told this, whatever you do, whatever you eat, now people in Kali Yuga would have said, Kesi, he is like so mean, man. How can he say directly whatever you do, whatever? So therefore he gave first Karma Yoga. So Arjuna said, kuch aur batao. Then he gave Gyan Yoga. Arjuna said, kya baat kar rahe, clearly batao. Then he gave Ashtang Yoga. Arjuna said, kari nahi sakte. Then he came to Bhakti Yoga. Does it make sense? In fact, 9th chapter he is giving various stages. 10th chapter he says, okay, do Bhakti Yoga. If you cannot do this, then he comes down. He says, then you do Ashtang Yoga. If that also you cannot do, then at least do Karma Yoga. If that also you cannot do, then at least do some social service. Like that, Krishna is giving various options. Okay? So, now one thing you have to understand. Doing things for the Lord's satisfaction. Karma Yoga had action. In between Jnana and Dhyana, no action. Happiness on the level of intelligence and mind. And then again bhakti comes, again action. Action, no action, no action, action. Are you able to understand the ladder? Why is action again coming back? First, if Karma Yoga, higher than Karma Yoga is Jnana Yoga, their action is not there. Dhyan Yoga is higher than Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, there also action is not there. So in Bhakti again action is coming, that means Bhakti Yoga should be inferior to Jnana and Dhyana Yoga, correct? How many of you agree? Why is action again coming back? Action means lower level, right? Why is Bhakti having so much action? We will see this towards the end.
You cannot live without it, sir.
We will see this. I'll come back to it. So, the thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. their lives are fully devoted to my service. They derive great satisfaction and bliss, always enlightening one another and conversing about me. So much bliss is there. This is not a dry process. My friends used to say electrical engineering is a dry engineering, because jo bhi hota hai paper par hi hota hai. All circuits are on paper, everything is on paper. At least you should touch and feel something, na? At least 440 volts, at least something you should feel a little bit. Everything is on paper. So I'm just making a joke out of, giving a humorous aspect to it. So other branches of yoga, especially jnana and dhyana, completely dry. But see, bhakti has that flavor. People are chanting, and they are chanting and discussing, always enlightening one another. Their lives are fully devoted to my service, and they derive great satisfaction. Satisfaction comes, happiness comes, bliss comes. You know. So there is a very, very nice shloka in Srimad Bhagavatam, which says, Sukha Rupa Sukhadhara Sarkara Pind Vanmatam Shri Krishna Charana Dvandvam Sukham Brahma Tu Kevalam. Krishna is considered like a piece of sugar, because the lotus feet of Krishna are considered like a piece of sugar, because they are both joyful as well as the source of all joy. Brahman, however, is only joyful. For example, I'll explain this in detail. Suppose we are making a kheer. In that, to make it sweet, what are we putting?
Sugar.
Try to use jaggery. This sugar is not good. Okay. Suppose we are putting some sugar in it, let's say. So that kheer becomes sweet. Correct? So what is the source of the sweetness in that kheer? Sugar. Correct? If I mix this kheer in somewhere else, let's say in another 10 liters of kheer, if I mix this kheer, will it become sweet? No. So sugar has a form, cubes. And the source, the form of sweetness is sugar, and the source of sweetness is also sugar. So Krishna's lotus feet are like that. If somebody has to say what is the form of, what does happiness look like? Lotus feet of Krishna. And what is the source of all happiness? Lotus feet of Krishna. So basically, all the happiness that is derived from the touch of the lotus feet of Krishna. So bhakti yoga is touching that aspect. Their lives are fully devoted to my service. Whether one is a scientist or a doctor or an engineer or a brahmachari or a grihastha or a vanaprastha or a sannyasi, everybody is doing service for Krishna. And they derive what? Great satisfaction. This great satisfaction was not possible in jnana and dhyana. And they are always enlightening one another about conversing about me. You imagine the life in Vaikuntha is eternal. Eternally they are simply discussing the Lord. How do they get new topics every day? Because the Lord is unlimited. His qualities are unlimited. This gives a very, very high level of happiness. Okay? For example, if in India, generally the names are related to God and demigods. But let's say if your name is Tinku. And if you keep saying Tinku, 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 how you'll feel? After saying 10 times, you'll feel tired, irritated. But if 10 times, if you say Krishna, 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 how you'll feel? She's highly realized. If you're getting bliss in just 10 times, your life is successful. But my point is, even if you say the names of Krishna for a lifetime, still you will not be bored. But if you say Tinku, 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 for 5 minutes, you'll be bored. Next time, you'll change the name of the person only. From Tinku to Mantu, something like that. So I'll give you a real proof of that. Even after a lifetime of chanting the holy names of the Lord, people are not bored and they get newer and newer pleasures every day. The proof is this. Okay, volume please. I found this very, very nice video. Somebody sent it to me, I put it here. See, this old person, what do you think his age is? Yeah. See, the point which I am trying to make is, see, this is a very, very old person. Probably billions of times he has taken the name of Radha and Krishna. But still, in this age, when it is difficult for him to walk, you know, you should see the video nicely, his feet are almost gone. But in that condition also, in this dilapidated condition also, in such a weak body also, when he is chanting Radha Krishna, he is jumping. So this is what we are talking about. We are talking about the holy name of the Lord. Even if you chant it for 50,000 lifetimes, you will still feel happy. But Tinku will not give you happiness. Okay. So see this, always remember this example, this old man cannot jump, cannot walk, cannot talk. He cannot sing also properly. He's, a lot of force is needed. But everything is secondary. He is ready to take all the pains and pleasures just to say Radha Krishna. Okay, so this is Bhakti Yoga. So then Prahlad says, Shri Prahlad Uvacha, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam Pada Sevanam Archanam Vandanam Dasyam Sakhyam Atmanivedanam Iti Pumshar Pita Vishnu Bhaktis Chenneva Lakshanaha Kriyata Bhagavati Adha Tan Manye Dhitam Uttamam. Prahlad Maharaj said, can Deepak Prabhu read this?
Prahlad Maharaj said, hearing and chanting about the transcendental holy name, form, qualities,
paraphernalia,
and pastime of Lord Vishnu, remembering them, serving the lotus feet of the Lord, offering the Lord respectful worship with 16 types of paraphernalia, offering prayers to the Lord, becoming His servant, considering the Lord one's best friend, and surrendering everything unto Him. In other words, serving Him with the body, mind and words. These 9 processes are accepted as pure devotional service. One who has dedicated his life to the service of Krishna through these 9 methods should be understood to be the most learned person, for he has acquired complete knowledge.
So see, in Bhakti Yoga, Gyan Yoga is already there.
Knowledge.
No, complete knowledge he has got. That is the high, that is the perfection of Jnana. Okay? Karma Yoga, we are seeing so many things. You know, dedication of the life, worshipping the Lord. This is all is Karma Yoga. So karma is also there. Now, Dhyana also will come. We'll see. And then, but karma contains detachment. So, we'll see how Bhakti Yoga is the sum total of all Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Dhyana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga. We will see very soon. Bhakti Yoga is performed with love towards the Lord. It contains 9 aspects of which are blissfully done with an affection for the Lord. Okay? So now, I will just summarize different kinds of yoga. So Karma Kanda, action according to scriptures. Karma Yoga means according to scriptures along with some detachment. Gyan Yoga means according to scriptures with detachment, but we also have some knowledge. Okay? Dhyan Yoga means meditation aspect comes in. All these Gyan Yoga plus meditation is Dhyan Yoga. And Dhyan Yoga plus love is Bhakti Yoga. So the love is missing. The service aspect is missing. Okay? So people will say Bhakti Yoga, you know, how does it have that detachment? I did not see any Bhakti Yogi being detached till now. Is it true? When you become attached to Krishna, Krishna is so attractive that you don't find time to get attracted to anything else. And that is the biggest detachment. When you find taste in Krishna consciousness, you will automatically lose taste for inferior things. That is detachment. That is the basic aspect of Karma Yoga. In fact, what Karma Yogis cannot do, Jnana Yogis can do. Karma Yogis, Nishkam Karma Yogis, they are able to get detached from result, but they cannot get detached from the work itself. But Bhakti Yogi can even do that. Prabhuji, aaj se aapka service change ho gaya. Okay, Prabhu. A Karma Yogi cannot accept this so easily. He'll be finished. Probably he'll die only. And of course, knowledge. If you read Prabhupada's books, what you'll get? That is the perfection of Jnana Yoga. Jnana means something which can take you out from the cycle of birth and death. If anybody reads the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam and Chaitanya Charitamrit, people are going to take a set also very soon. So it will give them complete perfection of Jnana Yoga. And when you attain the perfection of Jnana Yoga, you will get fixed up. You will start chanting 16 rounds every day. That is called complete Dhyana. You know, if you can chant 16 rounds sincerely, all the demigods which are there in the universe, they will come and touch your feet. That is the most difficult thing to do, you know, chanting 16 rounds sincerely. If somebody tells me, okay, you go and conquer the whole universe, remove Indra, you only sit and, you know, do this, do that, maybe I can do that. But if somebody tells me chant 16 rounds with complete sincerity, with complete absorption, I will say I have to struggle for that. Still I am struggling. So that is Bhakti Yoga. Okay? It works, it comes how? Through mantra meditation. And mantra meditation leads to mind control, and that happens by practice and detachment. Suitable practice and suitable detachment leads to mind control. And mind control is natural in Bhakti Yoga. In fact, anybody who does Bhakti, there are two byproducts of Bhakti. The two byproducts are Jnana and Vairagya. Knowledge and detachment. They are two byproducts. So you see, knowledge and detachment, where you are getting knowledge, detachment you are getting in Karma Yoga. Knowledge you are getting in Jnana Yoga. And in Dhyana Yoga, you are getting extra meditation aspect. So by doing Bhakti Yoga, no need to, when you become perfect in Jnana Yoga, then you will get knowledge. But by doing Bhakti Yoga, automatically that knowledge is coming to you. Automatically detachment is coming to you. Only you have to chant 16 rounds. That is meditation. And that will also come naturally to you when you start engaging yourself in service. For those people who do service, who serve the senior devotees, and when they get blessings, 16 rounds becomes kya hai, roz to kar rahe hain. The struggle to move from 2 rounds to 4 rounds, that will not be there in the life of a person if he serves the senior devotees, if he serves the Lord, and if he follows, reads Prabhupada books, basically if he gets mercy, if he has love towards the Lord. 16 rounds kya, Haridas Thakur used to chant 192 rounds every day. 192 rounds. How much time will it take, Mataji? We don't know. But he used to do every day. 22. See? 22 hours. 24 hours, we say 22 hours. He is chanting. It is possible. Bhakti can do this. The perfection of all the yogas is bhakti. So now I give an example of staircase versus lift. So the other yogas which we have, they are like staircase. And Bhakti Yoga is a lift. What is the difference between staircase and lift? SVH people should be able to tell.
Staircase
faster. Faster and?
Staircase you have to put effort.
Easily. No effort. So difference between staircase and lift is, it is faster and it has less effort. So out of all the people who are sitting here, how many people would like to go by staircase to Krishna? You want to take staircase? Okay. How many of you want to go by lift, which is faster and less effort to Krishna? Everybody is going for lift, only uncle is little bit. No problem. Try Prabhu. So why is it like that? I'll tell you. So Krishna only tells, Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayantite. Those who are constantly devoted, serving me with love and affection, I give them the buddhi yoga or the understanding by which they can come back to me. So what is he indirectly saying? Only those who are serving me and worshipping me and devoting their lives to me, buddhi yoga I will give them. All the other karma yogis, jnana yogis, they have to struggle on their own. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes.
So basically, effort is reducing. Okay. Next, what he says? No, sorry. Here, not effort. Time is getting reduced. To attain buddhi yoga, a jnana yogi may take billions of lifetimes. After that, somebody will give him some mahaprasad on some traffic signal, and then he will become a devotee. Billions of years he spent time in mental speculation trying to understand this, what is the absolute truth. Ultimately someone gave Mahaprasad and he became devotee, and then his life will be perfect. This Mahaprasad, if he had eaten on his own, he would have saved billions of lifetimes. Correct? So basically, Krishna is saving time. So faster respect. Later on, next loka, Krishna says, Tesham evanu kampartham aham agyana jam tamaha nashashyami atma bhavastha jnana deepena bhasvataha. He says, to show them special mercy, I dwelling in their hearts, destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born out of ignorance. So first, he is giving them buddhi yoga immediately. Time is being saved. And after that, effort. Krishna only is going inside their heart. And he is only doing all the cleaning work. And he is only doing all the effort and making all the thing ready so that his heart becomes pure and he can go back to God. So the work is also being done by Krishna and the time is also being saved by Krishna. So bhakti is a lift. Now all of you agree? We all have to save time and we all need to save effort. How many of you want a job where you want to work only 2 hours and you get more money also and less effort also? Everybody wants that kind of a thing, correct? You'll also go for lift? Oh, stair only?
Okay. Without any efforts, you want to
expect
something.
See, this is also one thing which we have to understand here. With your own efforts, you can never attain Krishna.
Okay, efforts because of Krishna's...
See, the idea is to attain Krishna. Somehow I have to get Krishna. But I am understanding that so many yogis are simply struggling from so many lifetimes, they are not getting Krishna. I have to be intelligent. Am I attached to the work? Or do I want the highest result? Please ask yourself this question. Am I attached to the work? Am I a sakam karma yogi? Or a nishkam karma yogi? Or do I want the highest benefit? Why am I a karma yogi? Because I want the highest result. But I want it at my own terms and conditions. If this is there, only then I will go back to Godhead. Otherwise, I will not go back to Godhead. This is little bit problem. If I am attached to the way I work, because Krishna is completely tira. In Vaikuntha or in Golok Vrindavan, if at all you say, why Krishna is doing this, I do not agree with this, you are out. That is Vrindavan. The love has to be unconditional. Because why? He loves you unconditionally. We have been doing so much crap from so many lifetimes, but still he is providing for us. He is taking care of us. What to say of these things? We do horrible things, but still as Paramatma, he is there with us all the time. Is there even one moment in any lifetime where he has actually left us? His love is unconditional. So he wants the same. If there is a line, 50 people trying to get something from Krishna, Krishna will give to the first person, then he will go to the last person and give. Then he'll come to the middle and then he can give it to the second person. Then he'll go to the third person. A fifth person cannot say, ki main to fifth tha line mein, mere ko nahi mila. This is Krishna. Nobody understands him. And whatever he does is right. And spiritual master is the representative of Krishna. That is why Prabhupada used to say, my spiritual master is never wrong. Even when he was wrong, he was right. So Krishna is like that. We, in our limited understanding, we cannot understand what's going on. And we cannot say that Krishna did, he allowed Karna to die. What is this? We cannot say that. Karna deserved to die. So similarly, by our own sadhana, by our own reading, hearing, we cannot achieve Krishna. It is not possible. We can only, this figure you see, this man is raising his hands up. Okay, his raising hands up is his sadhana. He's telling out, calling out to the Lord, please come and pick me up. This is sadhana. Sincere calling out to the Lord. Japa, reading, hearing, service, this is sadhana. And then Krishna comes and picks up. By our own sadhana, we cannot go back. Krishna has to come and pick up. So at least for Krishna to come and pick up, we have to do sadhana. But there are so many forms of sadhana in karma yoga, in dhyan yoga, in gyan yoga, and in bhakti yoga. If we take a gyan yoga process, billions of lifetimes. If we take karma yoga process, first after becoming perfect karma yoga, you have to come to gyan yoga and then billions of lifetimes. If you do gyan yoga, then you have to come to Dhyan Yoga. Ultimately, everybody has to come to Bhakti Yoga. Otherwise, it's not possible only. And Bhakti Yoga, how they come? Causeless mercy. Somebody gives prasad. Somebody, you did something, and let's say you are a waiter in a restaurant, and somebody has come to eat, and you served nicely, and he said, thank you, you are very nice. And maybe that person is a devotee whom the waiter is serving. So the waiter gets agyat sukriti. Waiter doesn't even know that he has served a devotee. He got agyat, spiritual life starts. By your own endeavor, you cannot go back home back to Godhead. You need mercy of Krishna, you need mercy of Guru. That is why lift is recommended.
Someone gets into troubles and through that he gets connected with Krishna.
That is also there.
What his effort means is even in lift also, like, I mean, not lift and staircase, but even in
sadhana you have to do. Prabhuji, if you were mentioning that sadhana you have to do in bhakti, if that was the effort which you were referring to, you are correct. At least sadhana you have to do. Chanting you have to do, reading you have to do, hearing you have to do.
That's also effort. No?
That is also effort. This effort is minimum.
You can't just think of bhakti yoga and reaching Godhead and all this.
See, bhakti means this only.
That's right. For that also effort is required.
This effort is needed. I was saying the effort which is there in Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga, that is not very, very wise to do. So that is the staircase. Compared to the effort which you do in Jnana Yoga, think about the definition of Jnana Yoga. Going to forest, collecting a deer skin, sitting not high. Compared to that effort, this effort is nothing. This is lift. You just have to get into the lift.
Even in lift, we have to press, like, some effort is there, na? If we don't press any button, we will be there only.
Someone else will come and press.
Like that, effort will be there, but
compared to the Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga and Dhyana Yoga, this effort is practically non-existent. You cannot imagine Dhyana Yoga effort. Do you know, to start Ashtanga Yoga, 12 years of practice is needed. To start Ashtanga Yoga. How many of you can dedicate 24 hours a day for the next 12 years to just start doing Ashtanga Yoga? That to no guarantee that you will be able to be successful in that or not. But 12 years, if you sincerely dedicate 24 hours a day, I am guaranteeing you that you will go back to Godhead in Bhakti Yoga. Because effort is less. Why? Because Krishna is doing everything. Krishna is telling you, do this, I'll take you back. Krishna is telling you, do this, I'll give you all the Buddhi Yoga. Krishna is doing everything. Do you understand? It's not possible also. It's not possible. Many people, you know, I have some Gita courses running in different places. They argue like anything. Why you ISKCON people are simply targeting Bhakti Yoga? Why not Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga? What is the problem with this? Actually, the people, they do not know that it is not possible only to do. How many of you can go and do that Ashtanga Yoga? You tell me. Or Jnana Yoga also. Jnana Yoga is also very difficult. You always remember that library example which I have given. That person simply sitting from morning 6 till night 10. How many of you can do that? Call only will come and then you will say, okay, after 4 days I will come to library. Book reading is only difficult. It's very difficult to read books.
In Devara and Durga, that fellow is arguing about Karma Yoga.
I'm talking about the same person.
We went on a tour on December 16th
that day. Yeah. So that is why for such kind of people Krishna has given the Karma Yoga chapter 3. So that they become happy. When they will become perfect in Karma Yoga, then they will come to Jnana Yoga. But always remember, from Karma Yoga you can directly come to Bhakti Yoga also. It is possible. Why? Mercy. How? Mercy. Because see, if a person's leg is broken, he is active person. If his leg gets broken, then he becomes inactive. Very difficult for him to stay on the bed because he is active person. He is used to running around. Now, for 20 days, he will be inactive. After that, coming back to activity is very difficult because inertia. 20 days, he is still on the bed. Therefore, sometimes Krishna neglects Jnana and Dhyana. He says you do karma yoga, directly come to bhakti yoga. Why? Because karma yoga is also action, bhakti yoga is also action. Not much difference. Okay, we'll see that now.
Prabhu, suppose a small child who has not been into the worldly activities yet. For him or her, it would be bhakti yoga first he should be stepping with, right? Because bhakti yoga will be actually covering up karma yoga.
Yeah. Everybody should do bhakti yoga, whether he is a cat or a dog or a human being. Even if he comes and dances in the kirtan, that is bhakti yoga. If he is eating prasad, that is bhakti yoga.
But Prabhu, you should have done something that comes so that to enter into bhakti. It is not easy to enter.
It's not easy. If the child takes birth in the family of devotees, that means
mercy.
Not mercy, he has done so many things in the past lifetimes. It's if somebody becomes, you know, takes birth in a family where people are chanting Hare Krishna, that means that he has a right to be a devotee since birth. I did not have that right. So these are not ordinary children. Prabhupada used to say that those people who are properly following the bhakti yoga principles and maintaining a sincere grihastha ashram, the souls who take birth in that family, they are Vaikuntha children. They are directly coming from Vaikuntha for some purpose. They are not ordinary children. So the purpose of life of such parents is to give them maximum opportunity for cultivating Krishna consciousness. Once a woman wrote a letter, once a lady disciple of Prabhupada wrote a letter, Prabhupada, since my child has been born, I am not being able to do bhakti properly. I am not able to chant, I am not able to... Prabhupada said, right now your child worship is your deity worship. And if you cannot take care of your child, you give him to me. I will stop translating my books and I will take care of the child. Because this child is not an ordinary child. It has taken birth in the family of devotees. That means the first priority is to give this soul everything which it needs. And just by doing that, all your karma yoga, dhyana yoga, ashtanga yoga, even bhakti yoga will be taken care of. Okay, so somebody who takes birth in such a family is not an ordinary person. Question, are we missing something in bhakti? Answer. Vasudeva Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojita Jnanyati Ashu Vairagyam Jnanam Cha Yad Ahaitukim Ahaitukam. By rendering devotional service unto the personality of Godhead, Shri Krishna, one immediately acquires causeless knowledge and detachment from the world. The goal of Jnana Yoga is knowledge, and the goal of Karma Yoga is detachment. All these things automatically they come. Okay? Now, this is a very, very good shloka. Bhakti pareshanu bhavu viraktir anyatra chayashatrika ekakalah pradyamanasya yathashnatah shtyush tushti pushti kshudapayo nughasam. Please, this is a very, very analytical shloka. Please pay attention. Devotion, direct experience of the Supreme Lord and detachment from other things. Bhakti, pareshanu bhavo and viraktir. Devotion, direct experience of Supreme Lord and detachment from other things. These three occur simultaneously for one who has taken shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In the same way that pleasure, nourishment and relief from hunger comes simultaneously and increasingly with each bite for a person who is engaged in eating. So here, pleasure is compared to devotion, nourishment and relief from hunger. And nourishment is compared to the direct experience of the Lord, and relief from hunger is compared to detachment. So just like you have this when you eat, you know, so nourishment also comes, hunger also goes away and pleasure also comes. So similarly, when you do bhakti, devotion, bhakti, when by doing bhakti also your bhakti will increase. Direct experience of the Supreme Lord, which is the goal of Dhyana Yoga or Ashtanga Yoga, that is coming. And then detachment from other things. So all the other three yogas, they are coming naturally in Bhakti Yoga. How? By taking shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And this is happening in a similar way, just like you eat. So this proves that nothing is missing in bhakti. direct experience of the Supreme Lord, the goal of Ashtanga Yogis. They are meditating on Lord Vishnu, they want a direct experience, they are not getting, but by bhakti you are getting a direct experience. Devotion is coming. Detachment, devotion means knowledge also, in a huge, you know. For example, if you want to become devotional, you have to read Prabhupada books. And if you read Prabhupada books, that gives you knowledge. Knowledge means sense control and good character. This is the definition of knowledge. So devotion automatically brings that. And detachment comes naturally. So everything is there in bhakti. Is there anything which is missing? Yes or no? No. Thank you. Now coming to the question, why Krishna skips jnana and dhyana sometimes? I've already explained. Active man, leg getting fractured and so many other things. And then how karma and karma yoga and bhakti yoga, they are a little bit similar. Karma also does action. Bhakti also does action. So Krishna prefers sometimes karma yoga next to bhakti yoga. You know, that's why many of the devotees, or many of us also, we have not practiced jnana and dhyana yoga. Directly we have come to bhakti yoga. Do you all agree?
Yes.
How many of us have got for that deer skin and other things? We have not done. It is mercy of Krishna. We were there on this stage of the ladder, he literally picked us up and he put us on the bhakti yoga platform. Why? Mercy of some devotee. Somebody gave us some Mahaprasad, somebody gave us some Bhagavad Gita, somebody gave us some Kirtan, we became devotees. Otherwise, becoming devotees is not a joke. If by own effort we want to become devotee, it will take billions and millions of lifetimes, that too no guarantee. Okay, so now let's see what is Krishna's choice of yoga. There are so many options in Bhagavad Gita. Krishna is also changing his versions every now and then. But what does Krishna like the most? Which yoga does Krishna prefer?
Bhakti.
Lift.
Lift. Very good. Now I'll give you Praman. Praman is like Yoginam api sarvesham madgatenantaratmana shraddhavan bhajate yomam same yukta tamomata. And of all yogis, the one with great faith who always abides in me, thinks of me within himself and renders transcendental loving service to me, he is the most intimately united with me in yoga and is the highest of all. That is my opinion. So this is the opinion of Krishna. He thinks bhakti yogis are the highest. You know? And therefore Krishna, again, although he's telling first to Arjuna, you go to heaven, then he's telling you should do this, then he's telling you think about jnana, dhyana, Arjuna is saying no, then he talks about bhakti, then he takes mercy on Arjuna, and then he gives him the highest truth. And then in the 18th chapter he says, always think of me, become my devotee, worship me, offer your homage unto me, thus you will come to me without fail. I promise you this because you are my very dear friend. The same Krishna earlier was telling you fight because you will go to heaven. Now in the end, 18th chapter, finally he is telling, this is the real thing. Always think of me, become my devotee, worship me, offer your homage unto me, thus you will come to me without fail, because that is your best welfare. Going to heaven or sitting on deer skin or thinking like a Sherlock Holmes, that is not your highest welfare. Highest welfare is this. You will come to me and I promise you. Why? Because you are my devotee and my very dear friend. Next he says, Sarva dharman parityajya maam ekam sharanam vraja aham tum sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami maashucha. Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. Religion means dharma. So many kinds of dharma are there. Desh dharma, kala dharma, apad dharma. Huh? Kaliyuga dharma. No, Kaliyuga dharma don't give up. Yuga dharma means chanting, don't give up that. So he's telling, abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reactions, do not fear. This is the summum bonum of Bhagavad Gita. If somebody asks you what is the ultimate conclusion of Bhagavad Gita, Mayavadis will not tell you this. Jnana yogis will not tell you this. Karma yogis will not tell you this. Only devotees who have the highest understanding according to Krishna will tell you this. That the purpose of reading Bhagavad Gita is to surrender to Krishna. But there are some fools who say the purpose of reading Bhagavad Gita is not to surrender to Krishna. What can we do? Now, don't use a wrong map. Bhagavad Gita is a map to the spiritual world. Many people are adding their own interpretations and translations. Some people are adding extra chapters also to Bhagavad Gita. Do not do this. All the WhatsApp messages which we come and the serials where we say Krishna is saying all these things, they are not all that. All that is not Bhagavad Gita. It is simply mental imagination. Stick to Bhagavad Gita. You know, and all these TV channels also which are coming, I will not take names. The things which they show, they are not bhakti. Maybe some of it is bhakti, maybe, but not all of it. I met a person once who says that I see this channel 24 hours and whatever it shows, I am so happy with it. That time only we understood that if he is agreeing with everything which is being shown in the channel, that means he is not doing bhakti. You know, devotional service of the Lord that ignores the authorized Vedic literatures like the Upanishads, Purans and Narad Pancharatra is simply an unnecessary disturbance to the society. Some people do bhakti, they say, I'll do this. But this is, Prabhu, but this is not recommended in the Upanishad. I don't care what is written in Upanishad. I'll simply do. I saw one of my friends, see, when you are offering prasad to Krishna, there is a procedure. It's mentioned in Narad Pancharatra. This is the procedure how you have to do. I saw one of my friends, he was like, Krishna is my friend. He keeps a plate and then from that plate only he's like eating like this. And then Raganuga Bhakti, like whatever they want, they will do. Bhakti also should be done as per rules and regulations. Okay? Otherwise, it will be simply an unnecessary disturbance in the society. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 1.2.101, Rup Goswami says, Shruti Smriti Puranadi Pancharatra Vidhim Vina Akantaki Harer Bhaktir Utpateva Kalpate. It's only Utpat. So, it's good that we are Bhakti Yogis, we are trying to be Bhakti Yogis, but do not ignore what is written in the scriptures. Don't just become emotional, don't just become sentimental and do whatever you want. Always consult. Otherwise, it will be disturbance for society and your family also. Always consult. Do not become emotional and start, if you are chanting 2 rounds today, from tomorrow if you start chanting 16 rounds, so many problems will come. In family only so many problems will come. First consult. Okay? So, follow what is there in the Vedic literatures, Upanishads, Puranas, Pancharatras, and then do bhakti. I'll tell you one example. In one of our hostels, on the New Year day, there is Jagannath Baldev Subhadra. Somebody put Santa Claus cap on Jagannath Baldev Subhadra. Everybody was like, all the boys were like, kya achha lag raha, it's so nice, this, that. But when the seniors came, they blasted that person. Where, in which scripture have you seen Jagannath wearing Santa Claus cap? Now that person was so happy. He was thinking, my Jagannath is looking beautiful. It is his deity, personal deity. And he was thinking, Jagannath is looking so beautiful. Jagannath must be feeling so happy. But who knows what Jagannath is feeling? You are thinking he is feeling happy. So we have to follow the scriptures. Some people while making prasad, they'll put so much chili and so much spices in it. Ah, I have to eat, na? Krishna likes it. But what Krishna likes, you have to read 17th chapter, shloka number 8, 9 and 10 to know what Krishna likes. Do not go on a sentimental platform. And all these TV channels which they are showing, they are not following scriptures. Simply they are becoming sentimental. If anybody who has read Bhagavad Gita, if he sees these TV serials, he'll go crazy. What they are saying. Okay, practical tip of the day. Very simple. Hear all the time. Whatever you are doing, whether you are cooking, walking or driving, just hear some kirtans, hear some lectures, memorize some shlokas. This is bhakti yoga. We are not asking you to sit on a deer skin. We are simply asking you that whatever you are doing, always some kirtan should be going on or some lecture should be going on, or you should try to learn the Bhagavad Gita shlokas. Try to learn and try to keep saying. This is samadhi. This is the highest form of yoga which is possible in Kali Yuga. Is it too difficult?
No.
Can all of you do it?
Yes.
Thank you very much. With this, I would like to end today's session. Any questions or comments?
Prabhu, I have a question.
Yes, please.
So, like each and every person on this earth is a soul who is part of Paramatma, who is part of Krishna. So like in today's date we have so many religions, like we are fortunate enough that we are here trying to understand, and we are with this country trying to understand. So people who haven't got that opportunity, they also would gradually fall into this.
That is why we have to preach. We have to go out and you have to distribute the books. We have to preach. Whomever you meet, जारे देखो ताहे कहो कृष्ण उपदेश अमार आज्ञा गुरु होया तारो ए देश. That's why Lord Chaitanya has said, whomever you meet, जारे देखो ताहे कहो कृष्ण उपदेश. What is कृष्ण उपदेश? भगवद गीता, भागवत.
Respective of religion and respective of,
whomever you meet, tell them about the भगवद गीता. You should know how to preach also. There is a technique. You have to learn that, but sincerely, with a sincere heart, if you go and tell someone, nah, just chant Hare Krishna, they'll start chanting. I've seen that. And you have, and how, on whose authority are you doing this? You're doing on the authority of Lord Chaitanya. So you should preach. This is becoming the messenger of the Lord. And of course, you have to distribute books also. Prabhupada's books. Prabhupada, same question one of the Prabhupada disciples asked Prabhupada. Prabhupada, you have come here, you know, you have some these many disciples, what happens to the rest of the world? So Prabhupada said, simply by reading my books they are becoming my disciples. Anybody, if he reads one line of Prabhupada's book also, Prabhupada become his caretaker. This is the mood of the Acharya. So if we distribute books, if someone reads it, becomes a devotee, that is preaching. If we do such programs where we are talking to people, see, my idea of coming to such Gita courses is that I want all of you to be preaching in future. First you save yourself, do your nice sadhana, you know, follow the ABCD properly, but then go out and preach. Don't just be happy with this understanding. Make others happy. If you are a true gentleman, you should make others happy. So go out and preach. This is the highest service. You know, if you really want to feel what samadhi is, try to preach once. You'll experience what samadhi is. Just spend some time in preaching. You will be completely revived. All your bad habits will leave you, and so many, you know, you will feel that, you know, you are a servant of Krishna. Preach, do book distribution, do seva. These things will actually help you. So the whole world can go back home, back to Godhead, if we sincerely try to serve the Guru Parampara and the desires of Srila Prabhupada. If we sincerely try to follow, by following our own sadhana first, you know, first save yourself, then save others. Does this answer your question? In fact, all these Sadgurus and Oshos and these people, and they exist because we are not preaching. We are not preaching strongly, these Nityanandas and all. You know?
E is equal to MC square.
The reason why these people are existing, because people like us, we are not preaching properly. We have to be more strong. We have to produce more manpower. We should just go into Nityananda. See, do you think any person who has read the Bhagavad Gita as it is written by Prabhupada, do you think Nityananda can defeat that person? No. So we have to go and strongly preach. When we preach like this, these Nityanandas, Oshos and Sadgurus, they will not have anybody to preach to. Because everybody knows the ultimate truth. Bhakti Yoga. That is the problem. We are not preaching properly. So we should all become preachers. It is my dream that I am coming here, I am spending time with all of you. It is my dream that sooner or later down the line, all of you should have your own Gita courses. And all of you should preach. Everybody should take a vow that in this one lifetime which we have, I have to create at least one sincere devotee. Now if I am a devotee, I have to create one more devotee. Everybody should take this vow. And that devotee should be like a nice devotee. Not like, you know, today, no, tomorrow, yes, not like that. Sincere Madhyam Adhikari we have to produce. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to say that if after selling all my temples and all my property and all my printing presses, if I can produce one sincere Madhyam Adhikari, I will consider myself successful. Prabhupada also sells in the purpose preface of Bhagavad Gita. If after reading this Bhagavad Gita, even one man takes to devotion, I will consider my effort to be a success. So that should be our goal. And it's not an easy thing. Lord Chaitanya has predicted, a time will come when in all the towns and villages, the name of Lord Chaitanya and the Hare Krishna Mahamantra will be sung. This is a divine prophecy, it is going to come true. Whether we participate in this mission or not, this will come true. But simply if we take up this mission and become soldiers of Lord Chaitanya and just try to preach, see what preaching we can do. Nothing we can do. But simply if we try, we will get the credit. Lord Chaitanya will say, he is my soldier or she is my soldier. What preaching we can do? Compare your preaching and my preaching to the preaching which Prabhupada has done. 70-year-old man with no money, does not know the next 1 month how he'll pay the rent, and see what he has done. We cannot do like that, but at least we can try. Then Lord Chaitanya will give us the credit that yes, he helped me in my mission. So I will request all of you to become missionaries and take up the mission and preach, distribute books, do 16 rounds, follow the four regulative principles, follow the ABCD, do Ekadashis, and yes, come to the mantra meditation circle every morning. Then only it will happen, otherwise it will not happen. See, we have started this initiative 5:30. If we come only, then we can progress. We have to give up a few things. We cannot be in the comfort of our, let's say, bed and want that we will progress in Krishna consciousness. That is not possible. If you want God, you have to give up few things. Bed is one of those things. Definitely. That means you have to sleep early. That means you have to eat less in the night. And that means you have to drink a lot of water the previous day. That also means that you have to eat less fried items. Otherwise, you will not be able to wake up. And that also means that you need an alarm clock. And that also means that each of you should call each other in the morning. It's not easy. But please try to do it. Thank you. We'll stop the recording.
It's already over.
Okay.